NiZ into Zines presents Taste Test, a sampling of fanfictions by NiZ fans, for NiZ fans, and maybe a few NiZ adjacent series as well. Introduction. I'll just give it the 10-minute test. Those are the words uttered by someone who wasn't sure if they wanted to watch a full movie or television show. If it doesn't grab me in 10 minutes, it probably won't. Some of us may enjoy a good story about our favorite purple jester, but not have all the time and patience in the world to weed through the masses of fanfictions out there. Welcome to NiZ into Zines Taste Test. We're giving you the metaphorical 10-minute test of several fanfics that were submitted to us for this special series. Before each one, we'll have a word about it, and then jump right in. No entry goes beyond 4,000 words, which is roughly between 6 to 10 pages. Not too much. You could read one entry each night, but not too little either. We've also included a link to where the fic can be found online, in case you decide, hey, I really like this, and I want to read more. Or if you read it and say, I want to drop this person a like for doing a good job. Don't have all the time and or patience to stop and read? No problem. On our website, we'll be hosting an MP3 of each taste test issue, where the writer, or a proxy, will narrate out loud for all of your fanfiction needs. Something not meet with your approval? Just skip to the next one. Color-coded page edges make for an easy navigation between works. Want to submit a fanfic or piece of fan art of your own? Send us a file or a link for a chance to see your piece featured in the next issue. Submission info is in the back of the issue. Just keep in mind that we're not editing anything submitted here. We will might format things a little bit to preserve paragraph flow, but that's it. So make sure your work is as cleaned up as you would like it to be before you submit. From the writer. I kept telling myself, since Sega doesn't seem to want to make a third NiZ game, I will. Because after all, you're better served by yourself. I've been loving NiZ for almost a decade now, and I had to make a contribution. This NiZ prequel has been around since early 2018 in my head. Supposed to be a fan game at first, the idea remained in the dream stage until 2020 when I decided to turn it into a fanfiction. Each character, especially the main one, Cassie, is a bit of a mirror of my real life, at least from a few years ago. Like NiZ into Dreams, my fanfiction is based in part on Jungian psychology, the biggest example aside from the canon characters being Fallen, but also more generalized psychology. The story is all mapped out in my head, but needs a lot of work because I want to do it right. I don't want it to be a simple fanfiction from a random person who likes the NiZ universe a little too much. I'd like for it to get as close to canon as possible so that at the end I can say, this story would make a real prequel for a game like NiZ. Obviously, it's a bit far-fetched, and maybe too idealistic, but after all, the opposite wouldn't be very me. For those who have already read what I published and are waiting for the next chapters, I would like to thank you first. I would love to continue writing it again, since 1 year is a long time. But patience is a virtue, and it's better to take your time than to hurry, just not to make the reader wait, with the final result failing to live up to the expectations. NiZ is a wonderful universe, and so is the fanbase. Thank you. From the staff. Dreamie's from France. She worked super hard to share her story with us in a language that's not her first one. I wouldn't be able to translate my fic into a second language without sounding silly, so I give her a ton of credit. I came across her fic when I saw the character submitted through an art site. There's gotta be an interesting story here. I wonder what it is. When she was willing to submit it to Taste Test, it made me super excited. Dreamie's cooked up a NiZ prequel / origin story. It introduces the man who will become Wise Man and then how he creates his first nightmare in Fallen. The story then follows Fallen as she navigates her new life, finds idea, whatever you want to call them, for her master, and then has to train the newbies, Rila and NiZ. There's an interesting dreamer in here, too, if we get far enough into things. My recommendation? Definitely worth the read. Dreamie is an amazing artist, and her story universe is super colorful and creative.
NiZ Before the Dream by Dreamie. Chapter 1. Long ago, at a time when disease and poverty were the masters of this world, a few peasants were struggling to risk their lives to survive the needs of their families. The Middle Ages, a very dark period, led hand by hand the Black Plague and so much more. Such was England at that time. Everard was just a craftsman, a puppeteer. He sold or gave his small creations to poorer people than he did. It made him smile to see all these little children marvel at his paintings, and their cries of joy when they had one in their little hands. But the problem was that Everard hated children. He had a daughter, yes, and a wife. He hated them. Go find out why he got married. He was the kind of people in his little bubble, introverted and not pleasant. It was only at work that he was a little sympathetic. He did not like it very much. He wanted more. Oh, he revered the nobles, the suzerains, and the kings, protected from all who had most wonderful life. But what struck the peasant's eye was power. It's true, dominating a kingdom was an interesting thing. Glory, wealth, immunity. He dreamed of it, but he was just a peasant. So his wife and offspring paid for it. He mistreated them. After all, he had every right. Wasn't he the one who provided for these ingrates? What would they be without him? They were his slave. Woman had to be treated that way. At least, at the time. They had to obey his finger and eye, or else they would suffer his wrath. It was the only possible domination Everard could ever wield, but he always wanted more. This was why most of the time he took refuge in his corner and gave life to his creatures, his puppets. His puppets. They could control them at will, without them rebelling, obviously, and there were only dolls of wool and of wood and rags. And this whole masquerade has been going on for years. But one night, it was enough. Everard had gone too far by hitting his daughter, a little too hard, which caused her to fall into the apples. His wife, horrified, quarrelled at him and took a good correction in turn. At the same time, exceeded and almost cheerfully, he hurried to fall into the arms of Morpheus. Tomorrow will be another day. Nobody. Empty. They were gone. Overnight. While he was asleep. At first, he did not react and suddenly began to howl and break the little furniture he had. His dolls paid for it, too. Had he gone mad? How could they have left? What was this betrayal? He was mad with rage and broke everything he had on hand before landing at a corner of his hut and drinking until sleep ensued. His sleep was restless. He dreamed of his wife and daughter and saw himself king or god. Then, full black. It was in the middle of a dense, cool fog. He felt like it was perfectly conscious. In fact, he was persuaded to be awakened. He walked in the void for a few minutes. After all, he had nothing else to do. The fog dissipated to reveal a large place under the starry sky. He didn't understand where, but there was a ho-ho pulled him out of his dreams. In front of him stood an owl, richly clothed. He seemed rather old and majestic. Well, it's been a long time since we've had a visitor to the Dreamgate. Dreamgate? Said visitor, arched an eyebrow, already a little impatient. Then the old owl explained everything about the Dreamgate, the night dimension, and the visitors. Then he introduced himself. His name was Owl. So, as I understand it, I find myself in the Dreamgate, in the world of dreams? That's exactly it. Well, this so-called world seems pretty empty. But tell me, Owl, why am I here? The owl howled and began to twirl over Everard. It's because your ideas are lost in this world. My ideas? He explained to him once again what the ideas were, and that there were five of them. Courage, purity, growth, intelligence, and hope. Red, white, green, blue, and yellow, respectively. The visitor was fascinated. This world seemed empty of everything. Maybe an opportunity. Owl looked at his guest from head to toe. Something swirled him. But not by physical, but by the aura of a visitor. She seemed so harmful. The bird regained its spirits and turned its attention to the right and howled with surprise. A door. Ho ho! A door to the world of dreams has appeared. Visitor, that means you must have to keep one of your ideas. Everard calmly walked towards the door, the spirit ruminating. He looked at Owl and opened the door. This door that would lead him into the world of his image. Said world was empty. Only a throne and a few columns of stone stood in the center. The atmosphere was negative, sad, and oppressive. Owl didn't like that. Everard looked at the place with great attention, as if amazed. The throne that stood before him was reserved for him, for sure. What if he made his world his kingdom? He liked the idea, being able to lead at his leisure without anyone stopping him. It was a brilliant idea. I will advise the visitor to leave. The place was not bode well, but the person concerned simply laughed at him, decreeing that he had to only leave, and that's all. And then that's all. He lingered on the columns. Small, colored, bright spheres had one column each. The famous idias. However, there was not that of courage. It must have been the one he didn't lose, no doubt. His aura became more and more harmful, and Owl realized the idias were beginning to be imbued with it. He tried one last time to dissuade the visitor, but the latter yelled at him that he did not need help. Frightened, the bird left. It was certainly one of the things he would regret. Everard continued to ruminate. He began to speak alone, to burst out with laughter. Madness, no doubt. He had projects, lots of projects, and they were far from positive. The idias were not as colorful as they used to be. Purple, brown, dark gray, and black. Cowardice, ignorance, corruption, despair, and bitterness. The spheres were uncontrollable, and so were their bearers. He imagined himself as a god, reigning with a master's hand over the small world that was now his own. It would be a terrible great. He was a prisoner of his own conscience. It was wrapped in a thick, dark halo that disappeared after a few seconds. Nightmare was born, as well as Wiseman. Nights Before the Dreams, Chapter 2, Fallen. A few centuries passed. Nothing. Emptiness. The Lord of Nightmares had managed to collect many idioms from visitors, lost, abandoned in the night dimension. He made fun of his backwards canary, unable to protect these so-called visitors. And he still dared to pretend to be Nitopia's guardian? He had discovered a power of destruction, but also creation. Thus, with the help of a few idioms he collected, he removed all positivity from them so that they were blacker than black itself. He now observed the corrupted sphere and rotated it around with two of his six hands. And then, like a puppeteer, he began to deform his shape so as to shape it to result in a small being endowed with life and consciousness. It wasn't supposed to be great right now. He did several tests, all of which were unique in their own kind. Once he had sufficiently convincing creatures, he sent them to hunt the visitors in order to obtain more ideas for an even more imposing army. The Nightmarins were born. But the latter were not so powerful as Wiseman hoped. Few returned from their mission to his great discontent. Or, when some failed them, he destroyed them mercilessly. There was no room for the weak. It was not enough for him, however. He had to create Nightmarins, more powerful, more nightmarish. And that's what he did. What he had to do to be convincing, to give goosebumps. A being that a visitor would almost be able to feel, or even worse, to visualize in themselves in them. These creatures would be their fears, their worst nightmares. These emotions that they seek only to flee will continue to pursue them until they are emptied of all hope and they sink forever into the meshes of despair. He continued to carve his minions while ruminating on his projects and greatness destined for success. Well, that's what he imagined. Once his new pendants were sent to the field, he continued to think about other projects. Sometimes one of his six hands would spy on Nitopia. He saw a visitor with Owl. They seemed happy, but he snarled at this thought, knowing that the dreamlike pleasure would not last. He felt a bright aura of the human idiot and constantly wanted to seize them as quickly as possible. He hated that joy. So he watched his second ranks do their job. For yes, as a good lord who respects each army as several ranks. There were the third rows, his small prototypes, which he continued to create as a visual means of distraction in passing. There were the second ranks, a little useful and effective in tracking down the idiots. At the moment, he was rather satisfied. But with each failure, he would just destroy them to create them again so that they would perform better. But in spite of everything, he was missing something. In himself, his nightmares were correct, but devoted to any intelligence worth, but devoted to any intelligence worthy of wise men. He needed a creature, endowed with intelligence, speech, and autonomy, a nightmare close to the human race, while remaining obedient to its creator. He needed skills beyond any rank he had ever created. Maybe it was time for him to create a first rank. He'd make it his right arm, being able to do his job in his place with confidence, continuing to cause terror in Nitopia, so his projects would be realized much faster, no doubt. He already knew that this creation would require more ideas and work, so he got to it as soon as possible. It had to be useful, it was obvious. May he give it a slightly sweet personality? That would be perfect for deceiving anyone. He gave her her own powers, which he considered very useful and almost invincible. This nightmarin would be the master of the occult art, would be the master of occult arts, divinations. This little being would have the ability to have visions, predictions, and would be able to read the future from a crystal ball, a tarot card game, or by simply observing the stars in the heavens. Maybe it was too focused, so he took care to anchor him some more generalized abilities. He switched to physics in himself. He began to sculpt a female body, white as snow. He offered her a jet-black hair, to which he added a purple orb. He dressed her in such a way that his high rank was valued. With a skillful finger, he touched her heart so that the little creature would come to life. The latter slowly opened her heterochromic eye and looked around. She did not say a word and raised her head in the direction of two huge hands that stared at her intensely, as if captivated. She was frightened for a moment and bowed to bow in gratitude to her new master. Fallen. You will henceforth be under my command as a right arm. You will use your abilities to serve me, and I will not tolerate failure. Otherwise, you will suffer my wrath. So far, his purple irises turned to a fraction of a second to red and yellow, a sign of certain annoyance. Is this well understood? She lowered her head sharply, almost terrified. It is perfectly understood, master. And his irises turned purple again, while his two iron hands moved away from the little doll. You are my best, so perfect creation. He watched her from head to toe, under the indifference of his right arm. Why did you create me? I suppose you did it for a specific purpose, master. You're right. Here I am the Lord of Nightmare, a world where only cruelty and despair reign. Nightmare? But that's not enough. I need to extend my empire to Nitopia, this cursed land filled with dreams and happiness. Oh. Once that's done, I'll take full control of the awakened world. I will be the ultimate god. No one will live without my nightmares tormenting them. He was caught laughing, very hoarse and nightmarish. You are ambitious, master. I am confident that your projects will be a perfect success. And you'll be very useful to me. She sketched out a brief smile. She did not know what to do. Just serve him, after all. It was thanks to him that she had been endowed with a soul, a life. But was she entitled to free will? Nights Before the Dreams. Chapter 3. Responsibilities. She had learned to live on her own. Her master had advised her to find out as much as she could about Nitopia, to know every nook and cranny, every little bit of information, anything that would be useful to the Lord of Nightmares. That would help him on his reign, no doubt. Fallen had finally met Owl, the latter having behaved in a cold and very suspicious manner. Of course, he was dealing with a nightmare, and after all. But Wiseman's right-hand man had been very gentle and pacifist with him. She meant him no harm. It was a difficult start, but they got along cordially in the end. Their conversations were very informative, as the old owl wasn't used to conversing with such an intelligent and conscious nightmarin. She had also met the Nitopians. They were very different from her fellows. The dream dimension was definitely quite populated, despite the terror of nightmares, but she hadn't forgotten her role. When a visitor crossed the dream gate, Wiseman would order him to send his minions in search of idiots. She too. The beginnings were difficult, but she ended up being close and impartial when necessary. Thus, when the idias were handed over to her master, she was careful to apologize silently to those she had wronged. She was torn between her reason for living and what she wanted. She did not know what she wanted to do. She did not know what to do. On the other hand, Wiseman was very satisfied of his puppet. She did a good job and knew how to live up to his expectations. Most of the time, anyway. She had special treatment compared to her siblings, which Wiseman considered perfectly normal since Fallen was his best nightmarin. She was his protege. Some of the other weaker nightmarins, who were often reprimanded, felt it, and felt bad and useless in front of the great Fallen. But the latter only wanted their well-being, so she acted like almost a mother to them. She made them understand that they were unique and that they were doing a very good job. That's what made Fallen a beloved right-hand man of Nightmare, loving and listening to anyone. It was also the right-hand man's duty to grant divination sessions to her creator. After all, it was one of her gifts, wasn't it? She had learned to understand and put her abilities to good use. She would have visions of her own or about more generalized things. But she didn't tell anyone about them. For the sake of balance and well-being, she preferred not to reveal anything. But Wiseman didn't want to know. She only told him a quarter of her visions, and only if they were about her master's plans. After all, he wanted results, not to waste time. She would sometimes draw cards for him, the tarot deck. Because this practice allowed her to read in her master and to predict the success of his projects. When time allowed, she observed the stars. They were useful in her predictions, and the more her knowledge and practice were considerable, the more effective her gift was. Sometimes Owl would join her, which she had come to appreciate since she felt terribly lonely. Despite the number of nightmares her master had created, none were like her, and she could not decently share discussions or even her personal feelings. Her fellows were not intelligent enough to understand, unfortunately. "Are you truly happy, Fallen?" She stared at Owl for a moment, taken aback as she finished writing down her final calculations on the position of the stars. "I don't know what happy is." Owl made a soft hoot. "Do you really appreciate your condition?" "Oh, yes, of course. I'm grateful to my master. After all, it's thanks to him that I'm here, and he's always been kind to me. At least, for now." Owl looked at her longingly. She couldn't understand, not yet anyway. Maybe in time? Or maybe she was really in tune with her superior's ideals. Yet, she seemed so gentle, against all violence. Did she feel compelled to do everything she did? "I feel an emptiness inside me. Like I'm missing some company. And yet Wiseman doesn't hate to create more of his nightmarins." The nightmarin lowered her head in sorrow. "I mean, I'm the only one of my kind. The others are too... deprived of life?" "We could look at it that way, yes." Owl nodded without saying anything. "I know you don't approve of our existence since we sow chaos and terror. Whew. And yet I confess, I appreciate your presence. Nitopia will be wide open to you if you wish to take refuge there." Fallen became paler than usual, as if frightened. "Betray the master? I would never do such a thing. He trusts me, and is satisfied with my tasks. I would never dare." Owl sighed. He was expecting this answer. He almost understood it, to tell the truth. Who knows how the Lord would react if one of his subjects rebelled? He was about to answer when Fallen uttered a little cry. He looked at her and noticed that her pupils had narrowed considerably. She was having a vision. When she regained consciousness, she looked at the interlocutor half surprised and happy? "Owl, excuse me, I have to go make my report." On her words, she flew away as fast as she could in the direction of Nightmare. A few henchmen who saw her pass by were also astonished. After all, it was so unusual to see Fallen flying so fast. When she arrived in front of her master, she bowed as a sign of respect and submission. "Well, you seem to have some news." Was he clairvoyant? No, he was probably just getting to know his favorite right hand by heart. She gave him a brief report, no visitor, and not a single idea exposed either. Wiseman was a little ticked by this report. He who desperately needed more ideas, despair, and above all, power. I also had a vision, Master. Is it relevant? Well, you be the judge of that. I, for me, find it rather successful? His six hands came dangerously close to his nightmare. He was all ears. Have you thought about creating more first-level nightmarin?
But first, here's a note from the writer. Hello, Animal Clue. My name is Kaede Hasegawa. Thank you for reading the first three episodes of Balan Wonderworld, Alina's chapter. This year marks the one-year anniversary of Alina's chapter, and it has been a passion project alongside another project that involves dragon cookies. Balan Wonderworld Alina's chapter is a magical girl take on a property. It takes many influences from Precure, 90s Sailor Moon, to even Yuki Yuna wa Yusha de Aru, Symphone Gear, and many other non-magical girl anime, like Revu Starlight. Some of my favorite things about writing this series are when things get serious, or when it involves Megumi and Balan. Megumi Shirogane is a girl that you think is normal, but later on becomes clear she is hiding a secret from everyone else. What kind of secret is hidden, and what is the villain's motive? Find out in Balan Wonderworld Alina's chapter. When I'm not writing Alina's chapter, you can find me on Twitter at Zaverick2, where I talk about anime, games, etc. Now if you'll excuse me, I have a dragon that is screeching for some more juice.
From the staff. Zaverick gave us a Balan Wonderworld fanfic, and oh my gosh, it is so adorable. All I knew walking into it was that it was a magical girl take on Balan Wonderworld. I grew up when the Sailor Moon original series was still coming out. Like, I got the final season hot off of Japanese television, not even subtitled. That's how new it was. Since then, I've seen my fair share of the genre. I've liked some, I've rolled my eyes at others. I saw the genre hit its high on the market and start to come down. I don't know all of the shows Zaverick mentioned in her description, but I know enough of the references to get a kick out of the story. You can see where some of the influence comes from, as you read. You might even point and say, oh, hey, that's just like... But not in a bad way. In an, oh my gosh, this is so silly and cute way. The magical girl genre doesn't take itself very seriously, but there is a definite and often serious pattern to it. Zaverick's got a good eye for catching those patterns, and she puts them all on display with a wonderful Wonderworld twist perfectly. Don't let the page count scare you. These three chapters read super quick. Her pacing is excellent. There's no filler and no room for material to be cut. I highly recommend giving it some of your time.
Chapter 1. The curtain is up. Why Dove Alina debuts. 8 years ago, Megumi is in awe by the stage. One day that will be me up on that stage. Present day. Now in Megumi's room. The alarm clock beeps. Megumi wakes up and turns off her alarm clock. Good morning, Ru-chan. Megumi realizes that Ruko is already at school. Megumi looks at her clock. Oh no, I'm gonna be late! Megumi quickly gets ready for school and heads out. Mirai Curation plays as she hurries to school. Mirai Curation, Curation, Menno Mae ni wa Hora, Te ga Todoku Hikari. Ah! Hoshiro High School. In homeroom. Ugh, barely made it. I tried waking you up earlier, but you wouldn't. I'm so sorry. You don't need to be sorry, just do better next time. Yes, Mom. Megumi Shirogane. Megumi stands up from her desk. Yes? Do you remember your homework from last night? Megumi explains literature. Nice try. See me after class. Megumi frowns as she sits back down. Now, lunchtime. Ruko opens her lunch and starts to eat. But Megumi starts to panic. I left my lunch at home! Why is there some bread next to your back? Oh, I forgot that. Megumi grabs a baguette and starts to eat it. Do you know what the theater club is doing for the next production? Not that I know of yet. Do you know what the handmade club is making? We're making crepes if you want to try mine. I'll have one when I get back to the dormitory. Oh, I see, well. The school bell rings. Let's hurry back to class before you get scolded. Megumi and Haruko hurry to get to class. Megumi accidentally bumps into Ryoma. Watch where you're going. Sorry. Meanwhile, outside the school. Hurry, or he will catch us, though. Me is gonna be fried if she gets caught. Hurry, to the school bushes. The three bird-like creatures hide in a bush as a commander-like figure tries to find them. I'll have to find them elsewhere. The commander-like figure walks away. Meanwhile, in homeroom, Megumi stares at the window as the teacher starts to talk. Barely making it to class, forgetting work, and bumping into the tech kid just made my day screwed up. Ugh. Is something wrong? Oh no, nothing at all. 3 hours later, the track field. With Ruko busy, there really isn't much to do since track isn't having practice today. Megumi starts to hear a bush rustling. Hey, what's over there? Megumi walks over to the bush and finds the bird-like creatures. Oh, how cute! Are you little birds lost? Mi-chan isn't lost at all. Mi-chan, you will hear us, though. I'm so sorry you had to hear that from us. Don't be. Oh, I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Megumi Shirogane, a second-year high school student at Hoshiro. What are your names? I go by the name Rei. My name is Do. Pleased to meet you, Do. Mi-chan is Mi-chan. Rei, Do, and me hear someone coming and immediately hide. Boy A. I failed the shot again and again. I'll never be good at basketball. The commander-like figure from before appears and targets the basketball player. Checkmates, captured at heart. The basketball player screamed as he was being corrupted and being turned into a basketball negaboss. The newly formed negaboss roared as Megumi was in shock.
What is that? A negaboss? Negaboss?
The commander figure laughed as he was petting his negaboss.
Saffron! Who's Saffron? He's the commander of the Nagati. This monster is just a negaboss.
Well.
It looks like you're trying to use a human shield just to save you. Negaboss, get her! The negaboss charges at Rei with full speed. Then Megumi grabs her and manages to get out of the way.
What do you think you're doing?
What is that child doing with the bird?
Protecting and helping people is something I am known for doing. Me? What are you talking about? Protecting those that I love and helping those with emotional problems has been something I have been known for since junior high school. That is why I, Megumi Shiragane, member of the Hoshiro Theater Club, will continue to help those who are lost and to find what is important to them. A stage light shined on Megumi and Rei. What is going on? Megumi notices a stick of light slowly floating down and changing form, revealing it to be the Wonder Stick. What's this? That is the Wonder Stick. Sorry, what is that in your mouth? Rei gives the thing to Megumi. This is a Wonder Crystal. A Wonder Crystal? Yes, insert the crystal into the stick and say enough, and the rest is a surprise. Could be worse, but it's showtime. Megumi grabs the spade Wonder Crystal. Wonder Crystal! She inserts the crystal into the stick. Curtain up! Megumi is completely silhouetted as the transformation begins. A white long-sleeved maestro's top covered Megumi's top area. A red bow with a blue spade appears on her chest. A red skirt formed covering her midriff area. As white high heels covered her feet, black leggings covered her legs. She put on a white top hat with red masking. Megumi grabs the Wonder Stick and starts twirling it around. Poor unfortunate soul trapped in negativity. I, White Dove Alina, the Feather of Love, will let you out of this cage and into the light. Ah, this must be the new me? Megumi immediately starts to head toward the Negaboss and kicks it toward the other side of the track field. What the? Megumi used an elegant kick and sent the Negaboss up in the air. Impossible! Megumi! What is it? Use your hat to look into the Negaboss! Okay. Megumi pulls down a hat, looks at the Negaboss. Ah! There's someone whose harm was taken away. Turn the spade crystal counterclockwise and unleash your attack. Got it. Wonder Stick! Megumi turns the spade crystal counterclockwise, points it at the Negaboss, and charged it up. Fly away! Spade shot! Megumi fires the blue spade at the Negaboss and completely shatters it into dust. It's all over. I won't forget this. Saffron disappears into the void. Megumi de-transforms. Ah, man, that was fun. That was amazing, Dove. You took that out with a bing bing. Michan is impressed. She still has a long ways to go. Megumi looks at a floating heart. What is that? Take that heart and return it to the unconscious victim. Megumi returns the heart to the boy, and he starts to wake up. Boy A. What happened? Scene. Kendo living. I'm back. Welcome home. I made dinner. I'll be there in just a minute. Scene. Megumi's room. Megumi looks at her Wonder Crystal and smiles. The team, specifically Rei, smiled as she saw Megumi holding the spade crystal. My start as a stage girl starts here. Megumi, dinner's getting cold. Coming. Megumi puts her crystal down on her desk as she left the room to eat.
We'll be right back.
Episode 2 preview.
Who are you? Your first mission is to keep your identity a secret.
Take this.
Who are you talking to? This is a casting crystal. Battle in Wonderworld, Alina's chapter. My first stage lesson. The stage is set and a curtain is up.
Chapter 2. My first stage lesson. In Megumi's train, a magician figure looks at Megumi.
Who are you?
The magician figure laughed at Megumi.
What's so funny?
The figure then disappears into the...
Wait, come back!
End of the train. Megumi quickly wakes up and sighs. Ah, it was all a dream.
Scene, homeroom.
Good morning, Megumi.
Good morning.
You seem a little perky this morning.
You bet.
Did you finish your homework?
Yep. Good for you.
Megumi starts to panic.
Was I hearing stuff?
You were hearing nothing.
Megumi opens her bag to find that Sims in her bag.
You guys aren't supposed to be here.
We are in your bag to protect ourselves, though.
Me!
Hush! Ray hushes me. Megumi sighs. Meanwhile, in the Neko realm, a wolfman figure stares down at Saffron in disgust.
What do you mean the Tims are with a girl? Bring me the Tims at once.
Yes, sir. The wolfman disappears in the distance as Saffron walks away with anger on his face. You will see my power, Lycos, this time. Meanwhile, at Hoshiro High School, on the rooftop, lunchtime.
I guess your friend isn't with you today for lunch? She is busy with the last finishing touches on the project.
I can see that.
In the meantime, we need to explain something.
What is it?
You need to keep your identity a secret.
Why do you say that?
This is to not let any evil people find us, though. Especially the paparazzi fishing for attention?
Exactly.
There you have it. You passed your first stage lesson.
That was a stage lesson?
Here is your award.
Ray, Do, and me came out of Megumi's bag and aligned themselves. Me hands Megumi a crystal.
Another wonder crystal? No, this is a costume crystal, though.
A costume crystal?
Yes, this is a tornado wolf costume crystal.
What does it do?
We will explain it later. Hey, sorry I'm late. The Tims quickly went into Megumi's bag.
Ruchan, how did the project go?
Well, someone was having a hard time with it, and I had to help them.
That's my Ruchan for you.
Megumi pats Ruko's head.
I'm not a child anymore.
Sorry about that.
Meanwhile at homeroom.
Who was that in my dream? I seem to remember who it was, but the name doesn't ring a bell to me.
Hey, are you okay?
Yes, I'm fine.
She seems to know who he is. No, I shouldn't let that get to me right now.
Later in class. Alright, we have your candle lighting project results. The highest score was a straight 100 from Ryoma Odajiri and Sora Terahashi.
Sora smiled at Ryoma while he gave a smirk. The teacher kept going on until he reached Megumi. Megumi Shirogane and Junpei Shiraishi received a 85.
Megumi took a breath of relief as Junpei gave her a thumbs up. Maruka Hashimoto and Aiko Uzumaki received the lowest score, 53. At the end of the day, outside of the school,
what is it that I don't have?
This is my chance. Capture that heart.
Aiko screams as she was being corrupted and turned into a candle negaboss. The newly formed negaboss roared as its flame was lit. Do and Mi were in panic while Rei calmed them down.
A negaboss has appeared! Saffron!
Megumi quickly runs out of the school and saw the negaboss stomping its way out of the school and into Yumikawa.
There it is!
It's showtime!
Megumi grabs the Spade Wonder Crystal.
Wonder Crystal!
She inserts the crystal into the stick.
Curtain up!
Megumi is completely silhouetted as the transformation begins. A white long-sleeved maestro's top covered Megumi's top area. A red bow with a blue spade appears on her chest. A red skirt formed, covering her midriff area, as white high heels covered her feet. Black leggings also covered her legs. She put on a white top hat with red masking and grabs the wonder stick and starts twirling it around.
Poor unfortunate soul trapped in negativity. I, White Dove Alina, the Feather of Love, will let you out of this cage and into the light.
We meet again. Get her! The negaboss quickly charged at Megumi. Megumi quickly dodged it. The negaboss then starts to spit out candle wax from its mouth. Megumi quickly panics and gets out of the way. The wax landed on the ground boiling. Touching it right now is not the best choice. 3 days ago, in the science room.
So how come our flame keeps going out?
It all depends on the wind.
The wind?
That's right. The force of blowing out a candle could cause the combusting gases to shear away from the wick, which is the fuel source.
Present day, outside of school.
Force of blowing out a candle could cause the combusting gases to shear away.
Megumi quickly grabs the Tornado Wolf costume crystal from earlier and inserts it into the Wonder Stick.
Costume crystal! Tornado Wolf!
She then pressed the button on the stick, and a massive gust of wind came out and hit the candle boss, blowing out its flame.
Impossible!
Now's your chance!
Wonder Stick!
Megumi turns the spade crystal counterclockwise, points it at the negaboss, and charges it up.
Fly away! Spade shot!
Megumi fires the blue spade at the negaboss, and it completely shatters into thin dust.
It's all over!
Why can't I ever succeed?
Saffron then disappears into the Nega Realm. Megumi notices something shiny on the ground.
Is that a costume crystal, though?
Megumi goes over and picks up the crystal from the ground.
Jumping Jack.
Megumi de-transforms, puts the crystal in her pocket, and returns the heart to Aiko.
What happened?
Meanwhile, in Gendo Living.
She should be back soon. I'm back. Dinner's on the table. Let's eat.
As Megumi starts eating, Ruko opens her mouth.
Shirogane-san?
Yes?
Are you hiding something from me?
Episode 3 Preview.
Why are you trying to hide from me? You need to promise me not to tell anyone about this. At this rate, we're done for. Do you trust me, though?
Balan Wonderworld Alina's chapter. Ruko's worries. The stage is set and the curtain is up.
From the writer. I like to build on the parts of the story that aren't very fleshed out at all. Especially the really obscure things, like the unused character self. I also noticed they never really explained the creepy-looking invincible alarm eggs and the significance of waking up being a really bad idea. I like the idea of the nightmare in each having a specific purpose related to their design and the idea, and that nightmares aren't inherently evil, wise men just grew power-hungry. From the staff. The Exile is a talented writer. The short stories are all expertly crafted and well-groomed as far as writing checks and double-checks go. The thought put into the lore behind these stories shows a ton of effort. But I can't focus on those for too long, as good as they are, because I've only just read the excerpt that's featured here from the Armageddon story, and oh my god, I have to read the rest! This one looks like it might be from an earlier time. There wasn't as much effort put into cleanup with it, but I'll overlook that because the story sucked me so flippin' right in! It starts off like a story about Ellie and Clarice, and I love those. But then all of a sudden, doom to the whole night dimension! I have to know what happens next! If y'all know me, you know that forcing the good guys and bad guys to face a common enemy is one of my favorite plot devices. This was bound to be one of my favorites just because of that. And the idea that Knights has been one of Wiseman's loyal servants for the entire duration of both games is one of those ideas that I've had floating around in the back of my head forever and never had a chance to write about. I love it! I need more! I haven't been this swallowed up by a story since Catalina's False Knightopia series. I highly recommend this one to you, and I hope it has a satisfying ending, which I'm going to addend on this one, or add an addendum. I have now finished it, and the ending is worth the read! Definitely sit down and read the extra chapters of Armageddon, the whole series. It's really good. You'll really like it.
Title: White Rabbit with a Guillotine. Writer, The Exile. If she took anything away from her experiences in Knightopia, it was that her unconscious mind was a weird place. Her dreams didn't even have the decency not to make sense, Most of the places at least resembled places she'd been, or at least seen, albeit horrifyingly twisted to match whatever her emotions were at the time. And knowing that you were being chased by creatures that took on the form of your darkest nightmares in order to feast on your soul is kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy of recursive feedback that just keeps spiraling down and down until you just turn around and face it. Even the bad bits weren't that unfamiliar. She knew how she felt most of the time behind that friendly opera mask she wore on the stage of daily life. She knew what a mess she was. Wasn't everyone? Take Puffy, for example. On the simplest level, the rotund, busty, opera-singing rabbit-balloon hybrid thing that wanted to kill her looked a bit like her singing tutor. Acted like her, too. I mean, the voluptuous diva had never overtly tried to kill anyone. Sometimes Clarice was a little concerned by how hard she'd worked her students and how intense her rage grew when anyone made a mistake. Some of the things she said bordered on actual death threats, or at least strong opinions that her pupils were worthless and could be replaced easily without anyone caring they were gone. Her praise, on the rare occasions that she actually liked something you were doing, tended to be just as passionate, though. In short, the tutor's moods were a force of nature, both benevolent and destructive, kind of like how she imagined it would be to live near a volcano. She knew you could power things with it and that you got really good quality soil, but she still wouldn't want to be anywhere near it when it went off. There were other things comprising Puffy, too. Rabbits, for instance. She had a bit of a phobia with them. It was normal for them to have red eyes, their bites hurt like hell, and she had once watched Watership Down by accident, thinking it would be a cute kids movie about animals. One of the operas she'd sung in once involved wearing rabbit masks, and it put her off so much it was one of her worst performances. That was another phobia of hers. Poor performance, stage fright, people realizing that she got such bad stage fright, screwing up at one important moment and callous people who didn't even know her, never giving her a second chance. It wasn't really Puffy's fault she embodied all these things, though, Clarice guessed. Wiseman had made them all that way. They were like trick mirrors in Soft Museum, showing you a distorted reflection of yourself in your worst light, tricking you into thinking you really were that ugly. It still made her look stupid if she blamed the mirror. It was still reflecting something real, even if it was a warped point of view. And now it was out in the open, she could deal with it better. That was what nightmares were for. Stages she could play out things about herself that she didn't dare think about in the waking world, or the consequences were so much worse. True, it wasn't quite as wholesome and therapeutic when the dreams were ruthless, shadowy predators who ate children's souls, but Clarice still appreciated the thought. That was why there was a sketch of Puffy hidden away in the middle page of her padlocked journal, where no one else would see, but she would never forget. Title: Roll Call. Writer: The Exile. Wiseman surveyed his new creations with the pride of a master craftsman, pride tempered with a critical eye that spotted all imperfections and allowed none to remain. Still dormant until the time he would awaken them, they slept, curled around spires inside the realms he had constructed along with them, environments designed to be most suited to their identities. The day of their activation would only come when he was satisfied that they met his standards, and he felt it would be strategically best to make use of their abilities. Also inside each of the realms floated a cage. The designs of the cages were surprisingly elegant, like gazebos hidden in the garden of a stately home. His cruel, overbearing personality usually led him to produce grander, less subtle works of art. Each cage was a different color. The colors of the five Idea. The Idea were the only things between Wiseman and total domination of the human world. They were the purest virtues of the human soul, the aspects of a person that made them strong against his corruption. Courage, wisdom, intelligence, hope, purity. All could be used to fight off his whispered words, and all five together were even more powerful than the sum of their parts. As he had been human once, he should have had them too, he supposed, but he didn't remember ever having a Idea, and he had no way of counteracting their power. He couldn't harness the power of the Idea himself. It was so antithetical to him that its light hurt his eyes and burned him to the touch, but he could use his own power to make an equal and opposing force, a darkness to the light, forged from the all-consuming darkness inside his own soul. So he had based each nightmare's essential nature on each of the Adea. Gilwing he'd created first, a serpent dragon. Wiseman had read up on human mythology and knew that the serpent was a symbol of temptation, corruption, and primal evil. The serpent was supposed to be able to tempt even the most innocent and pure of minds. That, and Gilwing's confusing movement pattern would reduce any human trying to dodge out of the way to the use of some very uninnocent words. In the chamber opposite bounced Puffy. Her appearance was roughly based around a grotesquely fat opera singer. The songs he had taught her were those from the stories with the most tragic endings. Nothing was more powerful influence on the human mind than stories, especially those wailed in a siren song, and hearing nothing but bad endings would wear away hope. He was unsure how to get Puffy to actually stay perched on a spire. It was something he'd work on later. Gulpa was a simpler design, a giant goldfish. Fish were scary on their own, with their completely alien natures to humanity and their cold, staring eyes. A goldfish was also a symbol of stupidity and memory loss. Watching him swim around and around his spire would distract the dreamer from thinking. Claws greedily eyed the goldfish from the next chamber along. Did he really mean to eat Gulpo, who was 5 times his size? Wiseman made a mental note that moving Gulpo and Claws further away from each other might be a prudent idea. The cat-like beast had elongated, razor-sharp claws and powerful hind legs that could jump onto the ceiling and hang there and wait to drop on any prey that wandered beneath it. His concept was based on the idea of predator and prey, that the most terrifying thing for a human was basically just a mammal who had risen up the ranks to become a firmly established top predator, was to become prey again. They did not know how to survive when they were hunted, not just by other humans, but by something designed to kill them. Although Gulpo, who didn't think about much, seemed unconcerned that Claws was watching him, it would strip a human's courage away swiftly. That left Jackal. Wiseman didn't like to admit it, in case someone accused him of being unimaginative, but Jackal's design was based off his standard template for Rialin knights. He was roughly humanoid, except that only his giant gloves, helmet, and cape were visible. He cackled insanely at his master as Wiseman approached and tried to hand him a deck of cards to shuffle. Jackal was the opposite of everything wise and sensible. Not only was he a madman, he was a gambler. Humans could not resist gambling, taking risks if there was a chance they would double their winnings, even if they didn't need more than they already had, even if they couldn't afford the chance that they would lose everything. Jackal didn't lose. Wiseman heard the faint rush of air that meant someone was flying towards him. He turned around to meet them. It was only Rialla and Knights, reporting back on their regular patrols.
"Nothing to report, sir," said Rialla, saluting.
"Nothing here either," confirmed Knights, before adding, "I'm bored."
"Boredom is good. Boredom is the opposite of trespassers," Wiseman sighed.
No matter how many times he fixed Knights, he ended up rude and insubordinate. He needed Knights to be imbued with chaos to balance Riala's lawful nature. There were plenty of humans who were afraid of chaos and plenty who were afraid of law, but he wished there was a different way of doing things that would leave Knights with enough intelligence to solve problems on their own.
"If it's okay, sir, may we see the new creations?" asked Knights.
"You may." He indicated them with a sweep of 3 of his disembodied hands. "Take a good look at them. You'll be commanding them in battle once we begin our invasion. I'm intending to put Jackal and Gilwing under your control, Knights, and give Claws, Gulpo, and Puffy to Rialla."
Knights spoke again.
"How come I get 2 and he gets 3?
Wiseman sighed. "During the performance tests, Jackal and Gilwing came out with much higher results. To balance their power, the 2 stronger are balanced against the 3 weaker," his voice betraying the strained patience. "Of course, that still leaves a slight imbalance, but I'm sure this will be counteracted by the fact that Rialla is a far more competent general who can actually follow orders."
Knights gave his brother a hurt look. Rialla folded his arms and smirked at him, then gave an embarrassed cough as he realized he was behaving, well, like Knights in front of his master. He frowned and said,
"So, when do we go to war?" "Very soon, Rialla," replied Wiseman. "Very soon."
The following is an excerpt from the story titled Armageddon, written by The Exile. Elliot half-heartedly bounced a basketball across the well-kept lawn surrounding the Twin Seeds Plaza fountain. He'd lost interest in basketball practice half an hour ago, and was now just doing something to pass the time. Every now and then, he glanced up at the ponderous old face of the town hall clock, then glanced down at his mobile phone. Still no messages. She was still late. Unless, of course, he'd lost track of time and failed to maintain an accurate representation of a timepiece within the dream he was shaping. It was hard to shape a dream on his own that was meant to be a shared dream for two. That was, after all, the idea of this dream. A sandbox world to host a tutorial for a beginning lucid dreamer. Their hometown, particularly the plaza where they met up every day after school and stayed until it went dark, was a backdrop familiar enough for them to both maintain easily, so they could focus on altering small details. Shaping the world would come next, once they'd mastered the art of shaping objects. Since traveling to Nightopia, freeing knights and defeating Wisemen, they'd been owning their gift whenever they could. Most nights, they could easily reach a lucid state and hold on to a dream long after they would naturally have woken up. Their success rate at sharing dreams and shaping their environment in a dream was steadily growing. They couldn't yet return to any part of Newtaboot, though, and they had never met knights. They had a feeling that the jester was watching them, probably laughing at their attempts like an adult watching small children pretend to be adults. But they guessed they wouldn't be shown the way to Newtaboot again unless they genuinely learnt enough to find it by themselves, or there was another dire need. The town hall bells tolled, and Clarice appeared behind him. Arms folded straight out behind her back, smiling sweetly and blushing like she always did when she knew she was going to have to apologize about something.
"Sorry I'm late," she said. "I fell asleep. I forgot it was Friday."
While they practiced whenever they could, it was less restful to manipulate sleep than to allow sleep to take its natural course, so they tended to only do so when they knew they wouldn't have to do anything that required being wide awake and alert the next day. And they didn't practice 2 days in a row. Elliot guessed that Clarice had been practicing on her own when she should have been getting rest. No doubt the tolling bells were her work, too. They weren't his.
"Get some rest if you're too tired to practice," said Elliot for what felt like the 20th time this week. "It's not a competition. We're supposed to be doing this in tandem. If you exhaust yourself all the time by working too hard, your rhythm's gonna go all out of whack and you won't be able to lucid dream at all."
"You wouldn't even have noticed if I'd done it right."
She frowned, but sat down beside him anyway, on the bench facing the fountain.
"I'll get it right, next time. I was going to surprise you with a new technique I've been working on."
"You don't need to work overtime, you know. You're not behind me, you're way ahead of me."
"I never said I was behind," she replied. "Why, is there some reason why someone would think I was behind?"
Elliot sighed. He wondered if she was like this all the time at school, too. If she was as good at other subjects as she was at art and drama, she was probably one of those scary workaholics that shut themselves in their rooms whenever they had exams.
"Can you at least make the bells shut up now?" he asked. "It struck way more than 12. Since when did the town hall have a 24-hour clock?"
"I thought it was you doing the bells."
It's not you? Okay, great. So either one of us is changing things and not even realizing it, or we're losing control of the..."
The clock bells abruptly stopped mid-toll, dead silent, in a way that real bells couldn't do. Didn't even sound like they'd been muffled or caught in something. It was more like a recording of some bells had been playing on a machine, and there had been a sudden power cut. The silence was more audible than the bells. It sounded like fundamental wrongness, like an omission of something that had always been there. Like looking up at the night sky and finding that the moon and stars were gone. Not obscured by clouds, but clearly gone. Then the ringing began, a continuous, frantic, high-pitched noise that grew steadily louder. They knew that sound. They remembered it from Newtaboot, and they knew to start running when they heard it. The noise getting louder meant that the cause of the noise was getting closer to them. Letting it catch them was a bad idea. They bolted to the other edge of the fountain, climbed up on an overhanging waterfall feature, and hid inside the grate where the water came out. Those things didn't look up as often as they looked down or around them in a circle. Their spotlights didn't swivel up very easily. It took Elliot a few seconds to wonder why the hell an alarm egg was in their dream.
They hadn't heard anything from Nightopia or Nights for 5 years. They hadn't seen a nightmare and didn't have the vivid nightmares that their enemies brought with them. Absolutely nothing life-threatening had happened in their dreams. Except that one dream about Clarice that she had caught Elliot having once. She really hadn't meant it when she said she was standing over him with a kitchen knife while he was asleep and that he would never wake up. Now, without warning, Wiseman's watchdog was prowling around in their dreams again. He wondered if he should summon his Redidea. It might protect him, or it might just alert the horrid things to his presence. He wasn't even sure if the alarm egg could be affected by Adea, like the Nightmarin were. Knights had told them not to try and fight them. When you heard the ring, you ran for it, especially if you were out of time. Running out of time drew them to you, and never ever succumbed to the temptation to wake up, no matter how scared you were.
Elliot,
whispered Clarice, her voice shaking. She was shaking too, so he put his arm around her. He wasn't sure if that was helping or not. He put a finger to his lips, but she ignored him.
Elliot, there's more than one. There's lots of them, all around.
He listened more closely. Then he realized why the noise was getting so loud. He assumed the alarm egg was somewhere very close by and hiding itself well. Now he could tell that there were hundreds upon hundreds of individual rings, synchronized without so much as a millisecond's lag. A perfectly coordinated army, moving as one. And he could tell, from where the noise was coming from, that they were surrounding him.
"They're moving very slowly. We might still have time," he began.
"To do what? We can't wake up. You know we mustn't wake up,"
she hissed, her voice coming dangerously close to a panic. "Maybe they haven't seen us yet.
What else would they be looking for apart from us? There's nothing here."
"If they'd seen us, they would rush straight for us. Maybe if we stay really still."
Suddenly, Clarice gasped, narrowly suppressing a scream, and pointed straight ahead. The front line of the first wave of alarm eggs was visible, as coordinated as they feared. And they weren't looking for a dreamer at all. They were deliberately, methodically destroying the dreamscape. The lights embedded in their faces were solid and glowing like laser beams instead of the dim light of the searchlights and tractor beams they used to capture the idea of a dreamer before forcing them to wake up. Everything those lights touched, they cut through, tearing apart the background so that it fell apart, leaving behind a stark, glaring whiteness. Elliot could tell as sure as he knew when a light bulb had burned out that the dreamscape could never be repaired. The exits had already been destroyed, all of them, at once. Elliot held Clarice tighter, but it was more for his own reassurance than hers. Then, suddenly, a flute played, one clarion note that drowned out all the infernal ringing for a brief second. By that time, both Clarice and Elliot had been hoisted into the air by a pair of strong but slender hands. They hurtled directly upwards at a dizzying speed.
"Those things never look up,"
commented a completely genderless and rather mischievous voice. Then they were dragged out of the dream, not into the harsh light of awakening, but further into the soft, warm darkness that contained the roiling chaos of raw, unformed dreams. As he swooped low over the pale, silent ruins, like shadows burned into a whitewashed wall, Riala saw the true extent of the damage that had been done overnight to an entire mare. It didn't mean he could quite believe it. It was everything that had been reported to him and worse. An entire invading army of Nightmarin couldn't have caused that kind of widespread destruction in such a small space of time. No correctly functioning Nightmarin would have tried to damage a system so utterly beyond repair, even one that belonged to the enemy and couldn't be taken. It looked more like a natural disaster than an invasion. If Riala hadn't already been to 3 systems affected in the same way this morning, and had been attacked in 2 of them by a force that hadn't quite finished escaping through the jagged rents in the very fabric of the dreamscape, all life and color drained out of them as though someone had turned off a monitor by throwing a brick through the screen that they created when they appeared, he would never have believed that the carnage was the work of an invading force. He used the term invading loosely. They didn't stop to capture territory and didn't target important military installations. Although they went instinctively after sentient lifeforms, they immediately drained their personal timeline. The things ate time. Riala had seen them go into a feeding frenzy over the crystallized deposits of time that collected in mares, where the difference between dream time and real time was unusually great, and then forcibly awakened them as though they were an enemy resource to slash and burn. Their only motive seemed to be causing as much devastation as possible whilst advancing inexorably towards wherever it was that they were going. Riala had been sent to follow them and find out where they were headed by observing the pattern of the mares that they destroyed. It had been Knight's job, but Riala's faulty twin had failed. Riala wasn't sure whether to be insulted that his Lord Wiseman had asked Knight's first and himself second, even though he was clearly the superior, or to gloat over Knight's failure, where he, of course, would easily succeed. Not that he would ever disrespect Lord Wiseman by showing any reaction to an order other than immediate obedience. He could tell at first glance that the entire mare was damaged beyond repair, just like the last three had been. There were different degrees of damage that could be done to a dream. Superficial damage to the furnishings of a dream, the appearance that a dreamer would perceive while they were dreaming, could be repaired instantly by any nightmare and with powers of illusory magic. Structural damage to the underlying, permanent shape of a dream would require a team of nightmare to physically repair it with duct tape and telekinesis. Then there was this kind of damage. Decay to the underlying laws of nature in a dreamscape, its very essence. If it was a computer program, its code would have been deleted, overwritten by garbled nonsense. An area hit by that kind of damage could never be rebuilt. Some areas hadn't been accessible, or even perceivable by any sense that a nightmare possessed when Riala tried to enter them to assess the damage. When he did step inside one, he ran the risk that the idea of flight had been deleted, and he would fall straight into an endless void. Eventually, the mare would collapse in on itself and disappear from the dreamlands. Lord Wiseman would be furious at the loss. He would order the mare quarantined and the defenses around the neighboring mares tightened even further, if it was possible for security to be more paranoid these days. So far, the invaders hadn't been able to get into most of the larger, populated mares. They were waiting for someone to forget to close the door behind them fast enough, or until they grew strong enough to force the doors open for themselves, or they simply weren't interested in those sectors yet. The Nightmarin were besieged, surrounded by an enemy that could destroy their very souls and who showed infinite patience. One good thing about this enemy, they could be destroyed in return. In the last system, Riala had spotted an alarm egg disappearing into a rift that had opened up in the spot where it shone its searchlight, completely replacing that spot. He drill-dashed toward it before it could swivel its face to shine the lethal searchlight in his direction. Its ringing was silenced forever as it exploded in a shower of cogs, springs, and glass. Then he had accidentally brushed his hand against the rift when he was shoving off against the ground to brace himself back into the air. He had lost three fingers on that hand. Lord Wiseman, who had built Riala using his own magic, couldn't regenerate the fingers. This mare had been long abandoned by both the invaders and the surviving inhabitants who had, usefully for Lord Wiseman, managed to escape and lock the gate behind them. There was nothing Riala could do except to know that they were still surrounded and outnumbered, then head back to face the inevitable report. Of the many things he wanted to do, including stick his remaining fingers inside more portals, being the bearer of bad news to Lord Wiseman was at the bottom of his list. He wondered if bribing knights to do it for him was an option.
Hello there, I'm Double, and since August of 2021, I've been on and off writing a series of knight stories. The first came into fruition after my friend Deck, who had also gotten me into knights in the first place, made a drawing of their nightmare and siren character called Kayo. Hint, she's in this thing. I originally just wanted to write a story about her, featuring Kayo, Knight, Deck, and myself, but it evolved into a saga after I finished the first one. Riala was also introduced in the second one, so we've got plenty of angst to spare. The little blip from below is from the fourth installment of the saga, entitled Double Trouble. Insert name pun here. Anyways, I hope you enjoy it, and big thanks to Deck for helping out with the voice acting on this one.
From the staff. The first bit of this I read was actually the last section of this submission, with Rilla and Kayo interacting. It was well dialogued, and I said I wanted to read more since it was way below the word count cutoff. Double was kind enough to share the folder with me with the whole series in it. I started at the beginning. The piece you're about to read is from Story 4. story one really impressed me. Some stories will struggle with pacing, but this one hit all the plot points just boom, 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 done. In the span of a few pages, a complete story had been told with a beginning, middle, and end. You may not know how hard it is to come across individual short stories like this one that add up to a greater story so nicely. It's more common to find chapters. Sometimes chapters have a clear beginning, middle, and end, but more often than not, they just convey the next section of an ongoing story. This episodic format carries into the next three stories, at least. I'm told story five isn't complete yet. No sooner had I finished story one than I wanted to pick up and read story two. The mechanics in-universe were a bit different than what I'm used to, but even that was sort of welcome. We get so used to things being just the way they are in whichever of the games we like better, that to see something different, like knights having a home, was a really creative concept, and I loved that somebody was willing to explore it.
Whoa. Double was nearly stunned by the beauty of the Aqua Gardens. Dex stared down at it.
Right? This place is by far my favorite Knightopian area.
Knights flew up behind the two.
I'm happy you two like it, but just remember that we're here to look for Idia.
The pair nodded, lowering themselves into the gardens. They all landed on a rocky outcrop next to the ship. Knights scanned the area.
All right, let's fan out. Search every little crevice. We can't afford to lose another Idia.
Double flew up onto the deck of the pirate ship, scanning it for any sign of an Idia. Knights flew off towards the Atlantis replica, moving rocks and looking under the coral. Deck, naturally drawn by the shininess of the sea glass, walked over to the beach area on the opposite side of the gardens to the ship. Double opened up the door to the captain's quarters. Walking inside, he scanned the room. He walked over to the corner, moving some of the crates aside in an effort to find anything. Leaving the crates, he walked over to the table in the center of the room. A map of Knightopia was laid out on top of it. He scanned it for a second before instinctively peeking under the desk.
What the heck is this?
He asked, seeing a small, gray button under the desk. He reached out and pressed it, causing the button to retract. He expected to hear something, like the moving of internal parts, but he heard nothing. On Knight's end, however, they heard something shifting, the sound of stone grinding on stone. They turned to face the Atlantis replica to see part of its exterior shifting to the side. They abandoned the rocks and walked over to the edge of the fountain, looking through the water and into the replica. They couldn't see anything, but they had a hunch. Double flew out of the ship, landing next to Knights. What are you doing?
Something in the Atlantis statue opened up slightly,
they said, pointing to the part that had moved. You think it'd have anything to do with the button I hit in there? Double pointed back towards the ship.
I wouldn't doubt it,
Knights said.
There's gotta be more of those buttons somewhere around here.
Double nodded. Then we've gotta find them before anyone else shows up. Knights closed their eyes, solemnly nodding back. They then took off towards one of the corners of the garden. Double decided to see what Deck was up to. Knights searched the opposite corner to the beach where Deck currently was, locking down an old wooden dock. It creaked under each step they took. They didn't fancy taking another swim, not after the last encounter with Kaio, so they watched where they stepped carefully. Knights walked up to a pile of wooden crates and barrels sitting on the dock. They decided to leave those for last, instead stepping over to one of the dinghies that were tied to the dock posts. They peeked into one, seeing nothing but fish hooks and a pair of oars that sat on its seats. Knights repeated the process with the next dinghy, not finding anything of note. They stepped back, placing their hands on their hips and looking around. They walked up to the side of the dock and looked into the water, ready to give up on this little area. Instead, Knight saw a little gray button embedded in the sand and water plants.
There you are,
they exclaimed. Knights laid down on the wooden dock, reaching their hand into the water. However, the button was just out of their reach by a couple feet. They sat back up, thinking about how they could reach it without taking a swim. An idea popped into Knight's head, and they reached into one of the dinghies, grabbing an oar and reaching back down into the water with it, finally managing to press the button. They smiled, dropping the oar back into the dinghy and heading back towards the two visitors. Whilst Knights was looking for the button at the dock, Double and Deck were looking for another one at the beach. The two scanned the sand and rocks, Deck picking up good pieces of sea glass as the two went. Double stopped at the end of the small beach.
Where else could these stupid buttons be? Deck shrugged.
They've got to be here somewhere.
Deck looked down at their feet, seeing light reflecting off a piece of sunglass. They bent down to pick it up, but something else caught their eye. Something that sure as heck didn't look like sea glass. They walked over to it, kneeling down in the sand and looking into the bush where they saw the shiny thing. Double turned to see Deck digging into the bush. Did you find something? Deck looked up.
There's something shiny in here!
They exclaimed. Double chuckled lightly, walking over and kneeling down next to them. He only stopped laughing when he saw what Deck had uncovered. Hidden under the bush, the top of a treasure chest peeked out. Deck smiled.
I knew being able to find shiny stuff would pay off one day.
Double smirked, lightly hitting Deck in the shoulder. Of course the treasure would find the treasure chest. Deck rolled their eyes, elbowing Double.
Just shut it and help me find the button,
they said, unable to hide a small giggle. The pair dug through the chest, picking up golden coins and necklaces, all of which were obviously fake. But the visitors didn't care. They weren't looking for gold and jewels. What they wanted lay at the bottom of the chest, under the pile of fake jewels and coins. Deck pressed it in, both them and Double hearing scraping sounds from underneath. The pair flew back over to the Atlantis City statue, meeting knights there.
Did you two find anything?
They asked.
We found a button in a treasure chest!
Deck exclaimed. They have a knack for finding shiny things, Double chimed in. Knights looked down at Deck's pockets, which were full to the brim with sea glass.
I can see that.
Realization crossed Knights' face then.
Wait, I only found one button myself. But there's still a section that hasn't moved away.
The trio sat there confused, unsure of what to do next. They started looking around the area, when suddenly, there was a loud scraping sound. They turned to see the final piece of the statue shifting to the side. Within the statue was a black casing, obviously for hiding something away inside of it. It too started to move, revealing the bright blue idea of intelligence.
I knew it! Double exclaimed. I knew there was an idea in there!
Knights nodded.
Indeed there is.
Deck shook their head.
No, wait. We found three buttons. Each one moved one piece. So if the fourth piece opened, then...
Deck looked behind himself, letting out an audible gasp. Knights and Double turned as well. Standing on the bow of the pirate ship were Kaio and Riala. Kaio's hand came to rest at her side, from where it last sat on a button attached to the wooden fencing of the ship. Riala smiled.
Hello, traitors. He spat the words out, like a foul taste on his tongue. Knight stepped up.
Riala, Kaio. I'd say it'd be a pleasure to see you, but that'd be a lie.
Kaio's gaze flicked between the idiot of intelligence and Knights and the visitors.
It's always a pleasure to see the visitors,
she teased. Deck clenched their fist.
You aren't getting the idiot, Kaio.
Kaio hissed at Deck, but Riala put up his hand, signaling for her to stop. Instead, Kaio glared at Riala, snatching his hand and turning to hiss at him instead. Riala wrenched his hand from Kaio's grip, turning to stand directly in front of her. Knights looked between the two, quietly getting themselves into a flight stance. With a swift motion, they launched themselves at Riala. He turned to face them at the last second, trying to hit them. Knights grabbed Riala and landed on top of him, pinning into the deck of the ship. Kaio turned away from the two to see Double and Deck launching themselves at her. They all fell backwards, landing on a small rocky outcrop instead of on the deck of the ship. Kaio stood up opposite Double and Deck.
Ready for round two, darlings?
Double stood as well, cracking his knuckles.
You'd better believe it.
Deck readied himself as well.
Yeah, what he said.
The trio stood, neither side wanting to make the first move. It seemed as though they were frozen in time. That was, until Kaio was the first to break. She pulled the water from around the garden and tossed it at the two visitors. Deck shot up and into the air to dodge it. Kaio tried to turn the water at them, but Double landed a punch to her chest. Kaio staggered back, staring down Double.
Watch where you put those hands.
She rushed forward, spinning and smacking Double with her tail. She went to hit him while he was down, but Deck shot in like a rocket. They drill dashed directly into Kaio, flinging them into the garden wall.
Deck landed gracefully in front of her.
I'd watch where your hands go,
they retorted. Kaio pulled water into her palm, getting ready to throw it at Deck.
I don't need to watch anything,
she exclaimed. Deck flicked their gaze from behind Kaio back to her.
I beg to differ.
Kaio turned, seeing Double jump up and off the side of the ship, using the momentum to punch Kaio, flinging her to the floor. Double landed, shaking his wrist. Jeez, that hurt me. Deck saw Kaio struggling to get back up.
Good move, but she's not down for the count just yet.
At that same moment, Riella and Knights came flying over the ship's railing, landing on the beach. The two immediately re-engaged in their battle, both of the two struggling to get a clean hit on the other. Double looked between Kaio and the two jesters. Deck, they need help! Deck stared at Double like he had two heads.
Are you nuts? I'm not leaving you alone with Kaio!
Just go help them, Deck. I can manage, Double yelled. Deck looked back and forth between Double and Kaio, debating what they should do. Behind them, Knights was knocked into the back by Riella, who jumped on top of them and started trying to punch them. Knights was holding him off, but they wouldn't be able to for long. Deck saw this, and after looking back at Double once more, rushed off to help Knights. Double took a deep breath, and then turned around to face his enemy, alone. Kaio and Double had their hands locked, trying to force the other to the ground. Kaio managed to use Double's own momentum to turn and throw him past her. She pulled water from the garden and shot it all at Double in tiny bullets. They all hit him like hail, forcing him to put up his arms to guard his face and stomach. Kaio used this time to pick him up and hit him with her tail. This tossed Double into the sandy beach. He tumbled, landing on his stomach. Kaio slithered over, chuckling.
You know, you could just give up.
Double struggled to pick himself up, out of breath. Oh yeah? And what would happen to me then? Kaio picked him up by the throat, pinning him against the wall of the gardens.
Well, I'm sure you could take a guess.
She dragged a finger up his chest, pulling it up his neck and across his chin. Double laughed. I'll tell you, I'm tempted. But not interested! Double revealed a sharp piece of sea glass, swinging it at Kyle's stomach. She was unable to dodge it, and it sliced her abdomen. Kaio staggered, placing a disembodied hand over her bleeding wound. When she looked down, her once blue stomach and hand were now stained with purple blood. She growled, staring down Double, whose green sea glass was also stained with purple blood. He pointed the sea glass at Kaio. If I ever go down, you'll be battered and bruised, he said flatly. Kaio stood once again.
Ugh, I'll show you battered and bruised,
she screeched. Kaio rushed at Double, swinging her tail at him. He dodged one swipe and then ducked under another. Kaio tried swinging another time, but Double instead grabbed it. He spun around, still holding the siren by her tail, and tossed her onto another rocky outcrop. Double flew over as Kaio picked herself up again. She pulled in the garden water once again and shot it at Double. It hit him directly in the face and tossed him back. He stood up, trying to clear the water from his eyes, but Kaio punched him before he could. She hit him in the chest, in the face, and then knocked him back with a tail swipe. Kaio picked him up and tossed him into the area of the beach where Knights and Deck were fighting Riella. Deck dodged two hits from Riella, blocking a third with their arms. They landed a punch to his chest, and Knights drill dashed into him, tossing him backward. Deck took a step back, walking into Double, laying on the ground, who was still trying to pick himself up. Deck immediately spun around.
Double!
They rushed to help him to his feet. As soon as he was up, Double squared up against Kaio once again. She's got me beat one-on-one, Deck. Deck stepped up beside him, leaving Knights to tackle Riella for the moment.
Riella isn't much easier to deal with.
A thought then crossed their mind.
Double, distract her. I've got a plan.
Double turned to them in surprise, but nodded. He stepped forward towards Kaio. Hey, barnacle breath!
You'll regret your witty, awake world banter, visitor.
Kaio snarled. She pulled the water from the gardens into a large ball in front of her and launched it out at Double. He flew off to the side, drawing the siren's attention whilst Deck flew off towards the Idia. Riella pinned Knights, readying a punch, but he saw Deck flying towards the Idia. Knights saw this as well. Reacting quickly, they kicked Riella off of them and rushed to help. Riella tumbled, but caught himself and shot off after the pair. Kaio went to shoot a pillar of water at Double, but Riella interrupted her attack. Aim for the flying visitor! He bellowed. Kaio turned to see Deck beelining for the Idia. With a single swift motion, she whacked Double to the side with her tail, turning to aim for Deck. Double flew into the air, using his flight to right himself and turn back around. Seeing what was going on, he knew he only had one option. He rushed forward. Kaio was still aiming her shot. The distance felt so much further, but he had to make it, or they'd lose another Idia. Just as Kaio lunged to the water, Double jumped in front, taking the full force of the blast. He was launched backward, flying into the water and tumbling, landing against a rock jutting out of the garden. Deck landed in front of the Atlantis statue, snatching the Idia. They saw knights flying towards them, Riala close behind. Deck immediately jumped forward, launching themselves at knights. The jester gasped in surprise, trying to duck out of the way, but to no avail. But instead of colliding, Deck jumped off of Knights' back, launching themselves full force at Riala. He tried to dodge as well, but had just as much luck as Knights. He was flung backward by the force of the hit, landing in the water. Knights landed on one of the rocky islands, looking up as Deck fell to the ground, landing gracefully in front of them.
Bam!
They exclaimed. Knights was both confused and impressed.
How in the stars did you think of that?
They asked. Deck shook their head.
I didn't.
They held up the blue Idia.
It did.
Riala emerged from the water, shooting up into the sky.
You'll pay for your insolence, he growled.
Double's arms shook as he tried to pick himself up. He managed to sit himself up, but as soon as he did, he was lifted off of his feet and pinned against the wall. Kaio had him trapped.
Well, well, well. What a little hero we have here.
She teased.
Jumping in front of the blast to save your friend.
Double squirmed, trying to wriggle out of her grip.
Let. Me. Go.
Kaio placed a finger on his lips.
Not this time.
She said.
This time you're all mine.
Kaio leaned in for a kiss. Double desperately tried to squirm away from her, but there was no use. Their lips connected, and Double's eyes shot wide open. He tried to squirm further, but there was no need. Kaio dropped him. He tried to get up and run away, but he couldn't move. He tried to scream, but nothing came out. All he could see was Kaio, bending down to his height.
Look into my eyes, Double. My deep, dark, majestic eyes. I want to see the light fade from yours.
Double started falling deep into unconsciousness. But suddenly, Kaio was gone. He turned his eyes to the right the little he could, able to see Kaio lying in the water, trying to pick herself up. Where Kaio once was, Deck now stood there. They grabbed him by the shoulders and shook him.
Double? Double, listen to me! Double!
Double could barely hear them. His hearing and vision was fading out. He passed out just as Knights flew over to Deck's side. The last thing he saw was Deck shaking him vigorously as his vision faded to black. Kaio laid back on the rocky beach of the dark ocean, leaning against one of the larger rocks that were closer to the water. She allowed her tail to hang into the water. The waves lapped over her tail, beckoning her to jump in.
Not yet,
she muttered to herself. She laid down on the sand, folding her arms behind her head. Her horns hung just out of reach of the water, only being kissed by the gripping liquid when a large enough wave crashed into the shore. She'd normally be monitoring the Dreamgate at the moment, but she had a feeling that the two traders left wouldn't be making any moves anytime soon. Until then, she thought, she'd keep her kings in the back row, waiting for the right opportunity to strike. Kaio closed her eyes, sighing deeply as the dark water pulled at her. She might just have answered its call, but something interrupted her thoughts. The sound of whooshing air from above her brought her back to reality. She turned behind her just as she heard the sound of something landing on the beach. Riala, clearly irritated, looked up from his graceful landing.
Just what do you think you're doing?
Kaio rolled her eyes, resting her head on the rock once again.
Resting. Can you tell?
Riala walked up to her right side.
I don't appreciate the tone, Kaio. Now, shouldn't she be monitoring the Dreamgate?
Kaio lifted herself off the rock, irritated at having to ignore the beckoning call of the dark ocean.
I can hear it just fine from down here. Plus, it worked pretty well the first time.
Your blind luck does not justify this action,
he boomed.
We need to be vigilant if we are to recover the few Idia we have lost,
and to find the ones that have not been uncovered.
Kyle poked him in the chest.
Well, if I remember correctly, I am the only one who has come back with an idea. I was the reason we were able to get that blasted blue one today.
Riella grabbed her wrist, his patience thinning.
And yet we almost lost it because of you.
Well, at least I took care of one of those visitors. I don't see Knights 6 feet under at the moment.
Riella growled.
We must focus on the idiot, Kyle. Visitor casualties mean nothing. Deck surely has many friends who would gladly take up Double's empty space.
Kyle bared her fangs.
You know what? I'll get on with that Dreamgate monitoring, as long as it means I don't have to deal with you.
Done with her co-worker, Kyle leapt into the dark water. There was a flash of light under the surface, and then she was gone. Riella heard a splash from above, most likely having come from the fountain.
From the writer. The strength behind this story is simple. I once read a fic that deeply saddened me, put Sonic Rush Adventures Sky Babylon Act 1 music on loop to help keep those feelings channeled and focused, and proceeded to weave take 2 either mostly or entirely in one shot. I hedge because I think I wrote some of the very beginning before the rest, but I can't remember for sure. Be ready for some powerful emotions if you continue. Also of note is I headcanon that the dreamers see knights as unlike them, so while he is used since it's Clarice's POV, Elliot would use she. Knights is comfortable with whatever a dreamer chooses to use, of course.
From the staff. What struck me first about Jazz's work is how well written it was. A lot of us make silly errors when we're writing and only catch them on a second or third read-through. I don't know if Jazz has already done several checks and rechecks, or is just blessed to know how to write well the first time through, but I was impressed with the quality nonetheless. Also, I find it increasingly rare to find stories about the canon Dreamer characters. When I do, it tends to be, kinda cringe. So to read a good story about one of the first Dreamers, I was just like, angel choir in the background. There's a heavy topic hit in this story, though, and it pushes the limits of the PG rating. However, as a mom, I see a teachable moment in here. If my kids are going to be exposed to unpleasant topics on the internet, because it's the internet, this is the kind of quality way I want it done. Understand that graphic depictions aren't always required to write a suspenseful or spooky story. This was very tastefully handled. Now, having said that, content warning is advised, reader discretion, and so on. The topics of self-harm and suicide come up in this chapter. If that bothers you, don't read it. Skip to the next story. But it's handled very maturely. Hurting yourself is wrong, kids. Don't do it. If you have thoughts about self-harm or suicide, you need to talk to somebody. A parent, a teacher, a counselor. Reach out to your family doctor and ask them for help. They will help you with a phone number. There's also a suicide prevention hotline. So, a quick Google search. Get some help. Now, on with the good story.
Take 2 by JazzJackalope. A one-shot text submission. Knights, are there such things as ghosts? The Purple Court jester retracted his hand from the knothole in alarm, then judged it to be safe and plunged it back in. This he had been doing since her dream started, and this he continued even now when she'd returned. So focused was he that he didn't seem to have heard her. What exactly do you mean? He finally replied, staring suspiciously into the tree's cavity. I mean a spirit, obviously. One that can't leave the place where it died for some reason. He removed the hand slowly this time with a few test thrusts. I have seen dying dreamers who don't fade away, but whether they can get into the waking world, I don't know. Another thrust, this one a sort of faint. Is that what you're asking about? To be frank, the Nightmarin's odd behavior was rather distracting. She and Elliot knew better than to ask when knights did such things, because he would offer up an equally strange reason as if it were obvious and ignore further queries. You're smart, inquisitive children. You'll figure it out, he'd say. Of course, they never did. I guess so, she answered. Yeah! The yelp accompanied a red and white blur attached to Knight's hand. He whacked it against the tree hard, and the kirkle, shell and all, shattered against the bark. Unfazed, he kept staring into the knothole. Not even close. Okay, well, I guess you're busy, so I'm just gonna go now. Intent, he gave a neutral sound as a response. She fled the area. Of course, he was a nightmare, easy as that was to forget. But knights could be scary for such a benign monster. Clarice was alone. She wanted to be. What was bothering her, she wanted to figure out by herself. Her room had gotten cold in late days. No, it had always been a little colder than the rest of the house. But now, so close to her 16th birthday, it had practically become arctic. Now, the supernatural was not what first had leapt to her mind, but in this odd world where it seemed almost anything could happen, it seemed as likely a cause. Not only was it cold, she could see a wisp resembling a human shape form in her room at late hours. She would brush against it sometimes, always in the same spot, when she went to the bathroom. Of her dreams, the most familiar was the soft museum. It felt like home. It almost was. The sculptures resembled her mother's work, and her house was a museum in its own right. The Sinclairs were an artistic family, and that hadn't changed in more than a century. The serene museum was not what met the eye, of course. Everything, to the building, to the ground around it, behaved as if it were made of rubber. In a way she couldn't exactly articulate, it imitated life. She hadn't been abused, not in the way that would cause someone to call child services. Really, when it came to what she went through, the term wasn't really applicable. Her parents were strict, something of perfectionists. They tolerated nothing less. But they hadn't beaten her if she failed to live up to that standard. Nothing so wrong here. But then, there were her strange dreams. She shook her head. This was not the time to get derailed. If the other night Marin, the one inhabiting the museum, knew she was here alone, he'd come for her. She had to do this quickly. When she and Knights had gone through the museum the first time, she'd only seen a fraction of the building's interior. The hall she now bounced down against her own volition had been well hidden. She had found it led to a mirror of the rooms in her house. Up the rubber stairs she tumbled, the irony of this not lost on her. At last she landed in what matched her room. No light pierced the darkness other than light showing the outside of the museum, limited to the window. When she had come here the first time, there was no way she could see. But feeling the same cold back then, she knew this room held the answer. And now she had a technique to fix the darkness problem. With a deep breath, she rested her hand on her chest. This process would be a little painful since she was removing a part of herself for the moment. But as she mentally clasped it and pulled, the pain was far less unbearable as it had been the first time. There was no scream, only an uncomfortable groan as she extracted her idea of courage. The dream orb filled the room with its red light, and there she was. In the furnished mirror room, on a chair, was the ghost staring up at the ceiling with intensity matching Knight's as he faced the tree. Calmly, she took her gaze away to match Clarice's. Her eyes were filled with a dull sadness, dull only due to the extent to which it filled the poor girl. But this sadness was not all that struck Clarice. The other girls seemed to be about her age and looked familiar, almost as if... Right then, too soon, Clarice woke up. She woke to birds chirping and the dawn coming in through her window, and there was the ever-present cold. A rollover brought the ghost into view, no longer a mere wisp, plain as day. Standing on nothing now, she still looked Clarice in the eye. "Who are you?" But before the ghost could answer, the clock rang, startling Clarice into full consciousness. The following day had been terrible, to say the least. Still stuck on her finally meeting the ghost that had been in her room for years, Clarice wasn't able to focus on a thing, nor really retain much else that happened. It was not a school day, but it did end with a basketball to the face and fervent apologies, and her attempts to reassure that she had actually wandered into the ball's path, and no one was to blame. Today, her goal had been only to get back into bed. Now that she'd confirmed the ghost's existence, there was an avalanche of questions, and she wasn't certain whether or not the ghost was still there. Perhaps she might have bolted after being seen. Of course, it was one of those nights where the more Clarice wanted to sleep, the more it eluded her. She tried everything, counting sheep, paying attention only to her breathing, even tried humming to herself. The cold increased at her humming for some reason, but nothing else happened. She merely laid there, staring at the ceiling for who knew how many hours. "You want to know why I'm here?" After what felt like ages, the other voice finally spoke. Clarice nearly leapt awake, unsure of when she'd gone to sleep. The dream was set in her room, as if she hadn't fallen asleep, but the ghost was there, on an actual chair. "Yes," she answered. "I do." Still exuding depression, the red-headed ghost looked up at the ceiling. "I killed myself in here years ago. That's all." "That isn't all!" She snapped it out before she got a hold of herself, but it was true.
I don't know why you did it or why you can't leave this room.
You want to know that?
Yes, I do.
No answer for a few moments. Then the ghost gave a heavy sigh and looked away from the ceiling. You're not going to like it. She stayed firm.
I still have to know. You've been here since as long as I can remember, in fact. If you can't move on, there's a reason, isn't there?
There's always a reason even the living can't let things go. By now, Clarice wasn't sure if the cold caused by the ghost's presence was some physical property or the result of her depression. Her voice alone sounded as if a heavy weight dragged it down to suffocate on the sea floor.
Come on, then.
With effort, the ghost got up from her chair, stretching clearly long, unused limbs as she left the dream room. A blast of light came in through the door as she opened it, and Clarice followed her into it. They came down the solid stairs, walking into an utter cacophony. At the grand piano stood Clarice's father, albeit far younger. His hard, red gaze came down on the little girl, who sat there clumsily trying to play a simple arpeggio and failing miserably. At length, he walked off with the deep harumph that Clarice knew quite well. Also familiar, the red-headed girl buried her face in her arms, sniffling to herself.
"So, you are..."
"Your sister," the ghost answered her. As the girl cried, their mother entered the room. She took one look at her young daughter and gave a disappointed sigh, but not so loudly that the child would hear. The ghost suddenly clasped an arm around Clarice's shoulders.
"You were lucky."
"But they treated me the same way."
"I don't mean like that."
As impossible as it seemed, the sadness in her voice only increased in weight. Leading her to another room, the ghost showed her a more recent scene. The girl, now of 12 years, stood at a canvas, not bothering to mask her disappointment in herself. Arms crossed, her mother watched her paint, sharing the same look. Clarice came around the easel to see the mess of clashing colors and misshapen forms that lacked any artistic merit.
"I couldn't do anything," the ghost told her. "There wasn't a shred of talent to be found in me. Couldn't paint, couldn't play a single instrument, couldn't sing. I'll spare you my tone-deaf wailing. I couldn't sculpt like mother, whether with stone or clay, and I couldn't even write."
Clarice watched as, eventually, their mother became fed up and left with an audible sigh. The girl stopped, staring at the canvas, hand clenching around the brush. She was too far gone even for tears.
"You were born with a voice. I never had a chance."
I don't believe that."
Confused, the ghost stared at her. She continued, possessed by an urge to reassure her sister.
"Maybe you weren't creative, but everyone has a talent. There was something out there that you could do."
And at that, the ghost laughed humorlessly. She didn't even have to qualify it. Clarice felt like a fool, arguing that point when she knew her parents wouldn't have supported any profession but an artistic one.
"I can say one thing. They didn't give up on me. Long after I gave up on myself, they still sunk money into tutors and lessons for every form of art under the sun. At some point, I couldn't take it anymore. I'd never be the child they wanted, and I just wanted out. And that's why I did it."
With that, the cold began to fade as the ghost left her.
"Wait!"
She stopped, looking back at Clarice apprehensively.
"What exactly was it?"
The ghost heaved another sigh. Obviously, she'd wanted to avoid this.
"You really want to know?"
Well, yes. Yes, I do."
"You'll regret it."
But without giving her a chance to rethink it, the ghost went to the stairs. She entered what had been her room, what was Clarice's now, and didn't even look back to see if Clarice was following. Clarice did rethink it, and she was sure her sister was right. But she had to know why her ghost would just stand there in their room, staring at the ceiling. So eventually, she came upstairs. The two sisters stood there in the empty room, in silence, until the older, at 16 years, ran in. Dry, but wild-eyed, she dove for her bed and fished under her pillow for a hidden knife. With great purpose, she pulled out the blade and, for some odd reason, found herself unable to use it. She just stared at it blankly, grip weakening until it fell to the floor. She flopped back on her bed, beyond crying, staring at the ceiling. Her gaze locked on the ceiling fixture. And she was like a woman possessed. Every motion she made was fluid, not a single wasted move. A dance that would only be performed once. She placed a single record on the old-style gramophone, the well-kept gramophone that Clarice had once found packed away in the attic. Turkish March came from the horn. Her sister turned it up loud and pulled a chair under the fixture with a single motion. Then she retrieved the knife.
No.
She'd begun to see where the older girl was going with this. Her heart leapt as the other sunk the knife into her gut, sawing a line across her midsection. Crying only out of reflex, the girl stepped to her writing desk and used her finger as a pen, her blood the ink. The message was simple, clear, and in cursive. I have no talent. We all must face it. No amount of searching has unearthed any gems inside of me, nor will it. I'm surrendering. Rather than live a full life of mediocrity at best, I choose to die now as the faceless nobody I am. Goodbye. With that, she stepped onto the chair. Horrified beyond words, Clarice finally looked away. The ghost of her sister held her, burying her face in her shirt, but she couldn't block out the noises. All through the ghastly process, the girl did not scream. There was a choking at the end, after the chair clattered to the floor, and that was that. Later on, far later, their parents came into the room. First their mother, with a disbelieving gasp, then a scream. In ran their father, who was shocked into stillness by the sight. They stared at their dead daughter in what seemed like denial, eventually coming out of the trance to find the note she had left. They seemed shell-shocked, working together in silence to cut her down, and inch towards the goal of putting her to rest. Here's the part that kept me tied to this room. Father held the girl as mother stood on the chair to reach the fixture and cut the rope. He stared down at her, and, by some train of thought, was moved to say, "It's really a shame." In death, she's shown quite the creative vision. And what was worse, mother stopped, examined her, and moved to agree. It was Clarice's turn to be shocked. No matter what kind of acute grief they were suffering and how rooted their values, there was only one term to describe that. Cold-blooded. The scene flickered out like a light, the theater dimming. They were back in the soft museum. Clarice tried to pull herself together, eventually able to come out of the trance that vision had put her in. Her sister stood by, and seeing her somewhat well, began to leave. Wait. No sigh this time, no dissent. The deep basins of depression that were her eyes fixed on Clarice's again. I don't even know your name. She shut her eyes. It can only make things worse. How much worse could it possibly get? Clara. On the verge of an emotional outburst, she locked up. What? Clara is my name. The meaning was not lost on her. Are you saying... Clara inclined her head as if it were hard to hold up. Are you saying that I'm Take Two? You were born roughly a year and a half after I died. Then they acted as if I'd never existed. I don't know if they forgot me, or they were just focused on my replacement. All this was too much for Clarice to take. She all but shut down, staring at the dark floor. Clara approached and clapped a hand on her shoulder, just holding it there. It was the kind of gesture their parents could never give them, even when they saw their children needed it. So Clarice clapped her hand on her sister's shoulder. She looked up to see that Clara had finally begun to cry. That next day, Clarice was like a woman possessed. Elliot was expecting to see her today, and she didn't care. She was to sing in a choir today, and she didn't care. Tomorrow was her birthday, when she would be as old as Clara was. She'd stolen a knife from the kitchen, careful to time things when her parents were both out of the house. Resolved, she pulled her desk chair out to rest under the ceiling fixture. The Take Two? The fill-in for a poor performer? The thought of them both being treated like a commodity made her sick. And so she was determined to show her parents that the second act wouldn't be that different from the first. Everything was as it had been. She'd fetched the old gramophone, and it was playing Turkish March. What exactly would they think? For all they knew, she had no idea she was anything but an only child. To see the one that had shown promise to go the same way. She raised the knife to her midsection, leveling it perpendicular to her side. And she held it there. Her grip weakened, followed by a clatter. What was she thinking? As cruel as her parents had been, they were not the only ones she would hurt with this act. What about Elliot? What did he do to deserve the news that his girlfriend killed herself for what amounted to sheer spite? What about Knights? Would he wonder what could have been if he'd only questioned her and found out why she wanted to know about ghosts? The choir group that may have to sing without her, knowing that what happened to their missing member, they did nothing wrong. And poor Clara, who didn't even want to show her life. There was a host of innocents she'd punish if she went through this.
Ashamed, she pulled the chair back under the desk, pulling the needle off the gramophone afterwards. Wise choice. She wheeled, and there was Clara, quite visible, standing where the chair had been. The sadness in her eyes had been alleviated a little, but as broken as they both were, she could only voice her relief in terms of what this meant of Clarice's artistic worth. The only thing more loathsome than a no-talent is a copycat.
From the writer. This short story was written for a prompt where someone suddenly had to spend a day as a Nitopian. For comedic justice, this had to be some despicable nightmare or another. Rilla was definitely a prime candidate. But the prompt was issued by a Knight's OC group, so including an OC was kind of par for the course. Having said that, when short stories are involved, I like to create completely new characters, and usually never use them again. Cleo is a one-shot character. She doesn't show up in any of my other works. I just like the name. Those of you who read my Belle and Wonderworld stuff, I kind of forgot this Marin girl had a similar name. You're meant to not like her. Please, dislike her. She's nasty and prissy, but she'll learn. One day. But don't think you'll be bored by an OC. All your favorites are in there. Jackal, Knights, Owl. Rilla didn't make it in this one, though. Sorry. Owl annoys the crud out of me in Jod, so I had to include all of his stupid little tics. Hopefully, as you read, you can hear him saying his lines. Visitor. Listen. Woohoo! You can hear it in your head, right? Right? Knight's gender is never brought up or identified. It is an art. Laugh with me. As I aim for a solid beginning, middle, and end, I hope you enjoy this one-shot short story. Maybe Cleo will learn something by the end of it, and maybe you'll have a laugh or two at her expense. Enjoy.
From the staff. This story does a great job of balancing the OC's character and development with enjoyable writing of the canon characters. Right off the bat, I like how Jackal may be fun-loving, but is still not to be trifled with, and I enjoyed his card-based power and fog pouring out of it like a wound. Cleo is indeed quite the fool to continue being arrogant during all that. She certainly looks proud enough for it in the included drawings. Our captain has, as ever, a good sense of rhythm and crafts a stream-like flow of events, making everything smooth, action included. Once you get into the rhythm, the story guides you along. The humor is a nice glaze. The story becomes very sweet and touching, with a nice conclusion. I also like the use of italics to set off Nitopian speech, which can't be understood by the Nightmarin. In short, even if you are doubtful about stories with original characters, I think you'll enjoy this at least a bit, probably more.
Curse of Humility by Anthro7. Cleo's hair was not behaving. She groomed it and groomed it and groomed it some more, sitting perched on a large tree bough. To call it hair wasn't really a fair description, though. While Cleo was one of the more humanoid-shaped Nightmarin, and thus one could argue that she did indeed have hair, it would have been more accurate to call it a mane. She had the same typical sphere-shaped head that most of the first-level Nightmarin had, but instead of the jester-style horns of her siblings, Cleo had cat-ear-shaped protrusions. Beyond the ears and all around where a collar and a V-neck shirt would have been was the fluffiest mane of hair, or fur, or whatever it was, that any Nightmarin had ever grown. A tad of it fell across the center of her forehead as bangs. "Keep licking it and it'll all fall out," Jackal muttered. He was perched on a nearby tree branch, practicing fanning cards theatrically. "Shut it," Cleo growled. "You're just jealous because you're nowhere near as beautiful as I. I'm practically perfect." Jackal rolled his eyes. "I'm so jealous I'm green with envy." His sarcasm floated by unnoticed. "There isn't another Nightmare in this entire section of Nightmare that can match my coat's beautiful sheen," Cleo continued. "Honestly, I'd be surprised if you could find another Marin in all of Night Dimension that could compare with me. The Master surely poured every ounce of artistic perfection into making me. I must be the luckiest dream alive." She went on like this for another 10 minutes. It grated, and eventually Jackal determined he would just leave to find somewhere else to pass the time until the dreamers began showing up. But Cleo suddenly departed from her narcissistic rantings and turned a barbed comment his way instead. "If anyone could see how ugly you were, you'd be so ashamed that you'd never be able to show your face in the Master's presence again, and that's why you're just a second-level reject and not a gifted first-classer like me. I'm the prize of the Master's collection." Jackal accidentally clenched his cards too tightly, and a few of them either creased or fluttered away. One side of his lip curled up. "What makes you so special, you pompous peacock?" Cleo sat up in a way that only cats do, with her back arched, chest out, and ears up. "Excuse me," she said indignantly. "I am vainer than a court of mirrors," Jackal shot, rising from his branch. He was taller than most first-level Nightmare and knew it unnerved them. He used that and the ominousness of his cape to cause Cleo to shrink a bit as he approached. It would do younger Marin some good to remember their place, he growled, where they can flaunt their power and where they're out of their league. Cleo gulped and flattened her ears but put on a hard face. She changed her posture to hunch her back and hissed menacingly at Jackal. Scavenger, she spat. When's the last time you brought the master anything more than some choked-on lunch? Jackal shot forward quickly and withdrew a card from the opposite glove. The sharp movement made Cleo flinch, despite her better efforts. The card being held in her face by two fingers bore a picture of a grim reaper attacking a flock of innocent Nightopians. I think you need a little lesson, cat, he said lowly. Cleo didn't care for being in close quarters with anyone if it wasn't on her terms, and she quickly drew back a clawed hand to scratch at Jackal's mostly invisible face, but she never got the chance to complete the movement. Jackal flipped the card and sliced it in half, shouting some magic phrase Cleo couldn't understand. As the card split, fog poured out from it like a wound and seemed to fill the night. Cleo hissed more and was about to scream when she suddenly felt the sensation of falling. A moment later, her face hit the moist dirt of the forest floor. Cleo quickly tried to get to her feet to scream at Jackal for spoiling her fur, but it was a difficult task. It felt like her body was three times wider than it ought to have been, and her arms felt shorter and clumsier. Her tail wasn't balancing her like it should have. But the worst part was when she opened her mouth to speak.
What did you do that for you?
Cleo clapped her hands over her mouth. Her voice had come out as a tinny squeak, and as she pulled them away from her mouth, she realized her hands were wrong, too. Her stomach crawled up into her throat as she inhaled to scream. Her hands were mitten-shaped and were about 4 inches big.
What did you do to me?
She shouted. A quick once-over revealed feet that belonged to a rejected rag doll and a body like a blue sandbag. Comically large tears burst from Cleo's eyes as well as the most deafening wail Jackal had ever heard. Sorry, kitty cat. I don't speak Nightopian, so scream all you want, but, he frowned one eyebrow at the tiny angel-like being on the forest floor. I hate to say this, and I mean to be gentle, but... He grinned nastily. You're quite stupid-looking, what with that cone head and all. With that, Jackal laughed and flew off on his way, leaving Cleo still screaming at him in a language that apparently only other Nightopians understood. A low rumble of thunder came across the sky, bringing the dimness of late evening to a close and welcoming in the night. Cleo shivered. She'd always hated the rain. Even on nights when she was scheduled to work the Dreamers for her master instead of for fun, she tended to stay indoors, away from the accursed weather.
I hope I can make it home before it starts pouring, she muttered to herself. You can't let anyone see me like this. I'm...
Tears almost started fresh.
Ugly!
The forest was very different this far down on the ground. Being a Nightopian had granted Cleo tiny wings and limited flight, but she had to work rather hard to get herself to fly in the right direction. If she worked her wings too fast, she floated away like a balloon caught on a wild wind. If she worked them too slow, she was almost faster walking. Finding just the right speed to fly at and then maintaining it was hard work. And even more frustrating was that the optimal speed for her little peon body to fly along at wasn't even a quarter of the speed she could manage normally.
Horrible, mangy forest floor!
Cleo tried to hiss. Her tiny mouth wasn't built for cat-like sounds, though. Brambles and creeping vines, fallen branches and stray flora, covered all available area of the floor. In the dark of night, it all appeared to be a tangled mess, set on capturing Cleo and her trick back to her lair.
When I get big again, I'm going to come through here and claw everything on these paths to shreds, she grumbled.
Up ahead, voices similar to her own were squeaking and squealing. If Cleo had still had cat ears, they would have perked up and forward.
Other Nightopians? Maybe they can... No, that's silly. Why would stupid Nightopians know anything about how to change me back into a nightmare?
Cleo trudged on, only half listening to the squealing and squeaking going on ahead of her. It didn't occur to the girl to actually listen to what the other peons were saying, or she might have realized that those weren't just idle squeaks she was hearing, but cries of terror. The noise ceased. Cleo was too busy brooding over her predicament to notice it first. By the time she did, she wondered where the other Nightopians had gone so quickly. A scared squeak came from her right, and she looked over. A trio of peons were huddled in a hollow tree, quivering, and they quickly beckoned for her to join them. Cleo scoffed.
Like I would ever lower myself to hiding in a tree with peons from a storm.
A low growl, like that of a lion, came from a few feet in front of her. Cleo froze. It came again, accompanied by a few crackling sounds. Cleo realized what it was, shrieked and flapped her tiny fairy wings as fast as she could. It almost wasn't fast enough. A gal pounced at the area where she had just been. That was what had been terrorizing the Nightopians, she realized. That was why they were all hiding. Claire tried to fly up into the tree branches, hoping to get lost in the leaves, but the gal chased her up. It had a lot less trouble flying than she did, and swiped at her with its two great clawed feet. It let out a roar and several shocks of electricity while climbing through the air toward the canopy. Cleo tried to duck over and under branches, but she really wasn't adjusted to using wings to fly, and her new body was a completely different beast to control. She ran into leaves and twigs, smacked her arms and feet on several branches, and eventually ran right into one of them. It gave the gal enough time to catch up to her and swipe at her back, clipping one of her tiny wings. Dazed and hurting, Cleo dropped to the forest floor again. She pulled her arms up to shield her face from hitting first and hoped that Newtopians bounced. Suddenly, claws snatched her up by the backside and whooshed through the tree coverings. Cleo screamed bloody murder. Calm down, spluttered an old voice. Steady wing strokes carried Cleo over treetops and across the forest. When she could get her head turned around properly to look, she startled.
Ow!
The old owl didn't stop to notice the Newtopian's squeak. It just traveled on. It wasn't heading the direction Cleo wanted to go, though. It was heading toward...
Oh, no,
Cleo moaned. Owl touched down in a stone courtyard with a pretty little fountain. A dream gate. Several sets of stone stairs led away from the plaza to archaic-looking doors with pretty little stained glass windows above them. Playing in the area were several other Newtopians and a purple nightmare that Cleo really didn't care for.
Hello, Owl,
Knight said with a wave. Owl let go of Cleo as he flapped to sit down on a glowing signpost. With one injured wing, Cleo dropped like a rock.
Well, hello there, Knights. It's good to see you.
Who's your friend?
The purple jester asked, kneeling down to examine the Newtopian.
Looks like you've had a rough night.
Knights tried to reach out to examine the damaged wing, but Cleo shimmied away. She frowned angrily at Knights and crossed her arms.
Let's see you get turned into a stupid Newtopian, and then come talk to me about having a rough night!
Knights laughed at the tiny pan's angry-sounding squeaks. Not to be rude, just because seeing such a tiny creature fuss so was quite amusing.
Oh dear, Owl said.
What is it?
It seems that this little fellow isn't actually a Newtopian, Owl said.
Cleo eyed the elder over her shoulder.
Oh, you speak Newtopian? Maybe then you can tell that sleazeball jackal to undo whatever he did to me. If the master sees me like this...
Cleo's demeanor suddenly went from angry to crushed.
Ew! Ew!
The oversized tears appeared on her little Newtopian cheeks again.
You'll think I'm the ugliest thing he's ever seen!
She began bawling. Hoo-hoo! The old owl blurted, flapping his wings and fussing with his waistcoat. That's quite a story.
What did it say?
Knights asked. The rest of the little Newtopians that had been playing in the courtyard were starting to gather around at the spectacle to see why their fellow was upset.
It seems this little one is actually one of Wiseman's henchmen, and Jackal turned it into a Newtopian.
Knights frowned.
Wiseman?
And to the paean,
why would you work for that old sourpuss?
How dare you!
Cleo burst, suddenly going into a rant about how wonderful Wiseman was, and how stupid Knights, Owl, and Jackal all were. Knights, of course, could understand nothing of what Cleo said, but the switch from tears to ranting and raving was one of the funniest sights in all of Night Dimension. The purple jester couldn't help but laugh. Owl, for his part, hooted and gasped and spluttered appropriately. When Cleo had worn herself out with yelling, she stopped to catch her breath. One of the other Newtopians patted her on the shoulder. Another offered her a flower. Still another offered her a tiny plate with a slice of cheesecake on it. These sorts of gestures were foreign to Cleo, and she didn't understand them, so she simply stared at the tiny creatures around her, confused.
You might not really be one of us,
the one with the cake said,
but we still are sorry you've had a bad time.
Cleo blinked. She'd never understood Newtopian speech before. With caution, she accepted the small piece of cake, wiped her face off on her sleeve, and took a bite. It was as though the rain clouds had parted and heaven had smiled on her. Her eyes glazed over with pure bliss as the cake melted in her mouth.
What is this?
She swooned. Cats can't taste sweet things, but Newtopians love them. The flock gathered around her and all laughed.
I think the solution to your problem lies in the north, Owl announced.
Why in the north, Owl?
Knights asked.
At the edge of the Frozen Bell, there is a nightmare that is almost as old as Morpheus himself, Owl explained. His name is Polaris, the guiding dream.
The Newtopians all quieted. Knight's eyes widened.
I've heard of him. Isn't he supposed to be the embodiment of the green idiot of wisdom?
Knight's asked.
Hoo-hoo! Well, I don't know about all that, Al said, but I know he is quite wise. Surely he will know how to undo whatever Jackal has done to you. Cleo snapped out of her cake delirium and nodded.
How do I get there?
Listen, Al said. You must travel through this area of Newtopia and back to the forest beyond it. Head north.
Obviously, Cleo muttered impatient.
Where the snow begins and the trees start to part. Look for a cave. But beware. There are creatures in that part of Night Dimension that come from Nightmare. They may look to cause you harm.
What hasn't tonight?
Cleo groaned. She turned to head off, but was met with another forkful of cake. For a moment, she was disabled by sweet bliss again. I'll take the little guy, Knight said. Cleo snapped out of the cake reverie long enough to say,
I'm a girl, stupid, and I don't like your help!
Knight scooped up the Newtopian in one arm and took to the sky. The flock of little peons on the ground waved and cheered goodbyes and good lucks. Cleo was silent once they were in the air. She wanted to protest loudly about how she was the most magnificent nightmare in all of Wise Man's domain and didn't need the help of a stupid rebel. She wanted to go on and on about how indignant this was making her feel, or about how much better than knights she could fly if she was back to being her normal self. But instead, she just sat there, quietly humbled, being carried by an enemy who was trying to help her. It was depressing.
I've been in your shoes before, Knight said. Not as an Newtopian, but... Let's just say I've gotten myself into a mess or two.
Cleo wished the ride would go silently. The sympathy was not making her feel better, especially since knights couldn't understand Newtopian, so if she spoke, it would fall on deaf ears. Below them, the trees began to thin out. A light dusting of snow had covered the ground here, probably from the same storm clouds that had brought thunder earlier in the night at the forest. Knights touched down at a clearing.
Let's start looking for that cave Al spoke of, the Purple Marin offered, without putting down the pian.
We were probably better staying in the air to look for it,
Cleo said, mostly to herself. For the several hundredth time that night, there was a low growl. Cleo let out a small while knights spun around to locate it. I am a dragon, as fierce as can be, and Marin, with pee inside, sounds delicious to me. A raging red beast came crashing through the edge of the trees. Knights and Cleo both screamed and leapt for cover, parting ways. The dragon went after knights as the larger and easier-to-see target. The purple jester took to the air, and the dragon quickly flapped its great wings and followed. Cleo, tiny and helpless, found a bush to hide in and whimpered.
Stupid, stupid jackal!
She blurted, fighting back tears for the umpteenth time. She'd never cried so much in her life as she had tonight.
If I had half of my abilities back, I could give that stupid dragon what for! Poor knights is going to lose a leg trying to outfly that thing, and it'll be my fault! Not... I care or anything,
Cleo assured herself.
Just, it would be a shame since, she sighed, since Nice was kind enough to help me, even though it was clear that I worked for Wiseman. We're enemies. Nice shouldn't have helped me. Those peons shouldn't have been nice to me. Al shouldn't have saved me.
Cleo's tiny peon head hung. The dragon and Marin fighting in the distance became nothing but background noise.
I've been awful to a lot of dreams. Jackal was right. I wasn't magnificent. I was an ugly, ugly Marin, inside and out.
She looked at her tiny hands.
Little hands like these were willing to help when my glorious self wasn't ever willing to bother with anyone other than myself.
A roar from the dragon broke into her thoughts. Knights tried to duck through the trees, not too unlike Cleo herself had done earlier, and crashed into some bushes in the process. The purple jester's lovely white sleeves were dirty and torn, and the purple leggings were streaked with mud and cuts. Seeing its prey had fallen, the dragon touched down in the clearing just about where Knights and Cleo had first landed. It rumbled out a laugh. Just this once, I'll have Nightmare and Main Course before my peon appetizer. Cleo clenched her little Newtopian fists and buzzed her little Newtopian wings. She burst out of her hiding bush and buzzed the dragon's head. He yelped and backed up, startled, trying to swat at whatever had buzzed him. Hey, I didn't order this food to go, the dragon burst. Honey, you picked a fight with the wrong girl today, Cleo shot, slamming into the dragon's eye, which, she thought after the fact, was really gross. He screamed a roar and reeled back. Knights blinked, emerging from the rumpled bushes.
Hey, I understood you that time.
Cleo wasn't paying attention to the purple Marin, though.
She was still busy buzzing the dragon's head, zipping between its claws, and banging into it wherever she could in order to disorient or stun it. "Wow! Well done!" Knights called, brushing off and quickly checking for injuries. Cleo tried to buzzbait the dragon toward the tree line. If she could get him close enough, she reasoned, she could convince it to try following her into the branches, and then it would end up injuring itself by accident. It was a good idea, but in trying to manipulate the situation, Cleo misjudged her distances. One buzzing pass to lure the dragon caused her to collide with a stray branch. The little Nidhopian crashed to the ground. "Come back here, dinner!" the dragon called. By that time, Knights had gotten back into the air and slammed a fist into the dragon's lower jaw from below, causing it to bite its own tongue. The dragon cried out in pain and refocused again. Cleo had landed with a harsh thud and rolled across the ground toward the edge of where the snow met the forest. She tried to lift her little head, but it was hard when she was disoriented. There was a tree in front of her, she thought, but it was hollow where it touched the ground. No, wait. Maybe it was two trees, and she was staring at a space between them. A silvery snake with wings where any other animal would have had ears came sliding up out of the opening between the two trees. Cleo got her head up a little more to make sure she wasn't seeing things. As the creature rose further up, she saw it had a second set of wings halfway down its serpentine body, and a third set nearer its tail, which coiled under it as it regarded her. It had a long white beard. Weird, she thought. Guess I'm dinner one way or another today, Cleo sighed, putting her head back down. Did you travel this far to become a meal? The old serpent asked. No, Cleo said. I came to ask a dream called Polaris for help getting myself turned back to normal. The serpent tilted its head at her. What are you deathly afraid of? It asked. Being not beautiful, I thought, she said. But now I think I'm more afraid of being helpless and weak. Can you please help Knights not get eaten by that dragon? The serpent frowned at her. Why not go help Knights yourself? Cleo blinked and sat up, confused, which is when she noticed that her legs were longer and curled under her in a way that they always had when she sat up. Startled, she leapt into the air and looked herself over. Her feline humanoid body had returned. A ray of morning sunlight caught her peripheral vision. A bad dream only lasts until morning, little one, Polaris said, and slipped back into its cave. Cleo grinned, feeling all of her strength and pride returning. She leapt into action alongside Knights. The duo gave that dragon a whooping of wallops and paraloops, sluggings and clawings, drill dashes and bull rushes. Eventually, the poor thing couldn't see straight anymore and collapsed over backwards out of it. The two Nightmaren cheered with victory and slapped a high five. You know, you're not half bad, Rebel, Cleo said. Knights laughed. Says the prissy princess. Cleo's face started to burn a little. Yeah, well, she tried to think of something to say to save face and sound tough, but before she could, Knights held out a hand. Well done. Cleo just stared at it a moment. It was like the cake, an unprecedented gesture. Cautiously, she accepted the purple jester's hand and shook it. Well done yourself, she said back. Knights smiled, waved, turned, and started to head off over the forest again. Till next time, kitty cat! It's Cleo, she called after her new friend, then shivered at the idea. Nightmaren don't have friends. They have enemies, or sometimes allies. But maybe next time I'll bring the cheesecake, she said. Knights smiled and disappeared. Cleo's eyes narrowed and she grinned mischievously. And maybe I'll make an extra to slam Jekyll in the face with the next time I see him. The end.
We hope you enjoyed this first issue of Knights and Zines Taste Test. If you would like to submit your writing or art for the next Taste Test issue, send us a message on Twitter at IntoZines. Or join our Discord server and hit up the Taste Test channel. There's a link in the PDF format file. Or if you can't do either of those, email the editor-in-chief at dreamer7@sweet-dreams-boutique.com. While we're here, though, we'd like to lay down some ground rules for submission. First off, the staff reserves the right to not include your work, for whatever reason, if they come to a decision as a whole that it's not suited for the Taste Test series. That might mean it's too graphic, or there's too much cursing, or the editing is absolutely atrocious and no one can read it, or just that we all felt uncomfortable with it. We'll still try to be super fair, but if 90% of the staff all agree that something might be too offensive and not be in an issue, then we're sorry, but it's not making it into our publication today. Second off, aim for a G or PG rating. That's general audiences or all ages, or parental guidance suggested, older kids' ages, like a DreamWorks movie. If your work would require a PG-13, NC-17, or R rating, it's probably not good for taste test. Those ratings restrict children under 13, children under 17, and children under 18. The standard rule of thumb is, if you wouldn't feel comfortable letting your mother read this and know that you wrote it, then you probably shouldn't send it to us. Third, please limit submissions to 4,000 words maximum. If you shoot us a link to a 10,000-word novel and don't tell us what part you want included, we're only going to grab the first chapter or the first 4,000 words, whichever is easier for us to do. If you would like to squeeze parts of several chapters into 4,000, then by all means, send us several chapters. But curate that yourself. Keep in mind that copy and pasting text from some websites doesn't always work easily for us. When we were trying to pull for this first taste test, not all websites would allow us to copy the text to insert it into our own documents. So the easiest and best thing to do is, if you want to have your text in the next taste test issue, send us a text file, a rich text file, a Google Doc, some kind of online text document of your material so that we're able to copy and paste it into the final product. Fourth, we do not edit. This was said elsewhere back in the beginning, but we're restating it. If you don't want the world seeing all of your bad grammar, misused dialogue tags, lack of Oxford commas, run-on sentences, accidental typos, just ask a friend to real quick double-check your things with you. Have someone you trust proof your work. A second look is always wise, and don't be offended if somebody points out with the red pen all the little mistakes, because once they're corrected, you look a lot smarter. A second look is always wise. Spam those blue and green ideas. Fifth, if you've got a fan art that goes with your story, send it to us. That's great. We will try our hardest to fit your fan art in with your story. Sometimes there's not a happy way to make everything fit. Your writing might run too close to the bottom of a page. And if that's the case, we're sorry. We will try to fit your fan art in during the fantastic fan art portion of the main issue of the zine. Or maybe we can give you an extra page. It really depends on how the format flows that day. Know that we will try, but you try too. If you've got extra fan art, send it in. We will try our best to get it in there for you. If you have a Knights into Dreams fanfiction, a Balan Wonderworld fanfiction, a Knights adjacent series fanfiction, a crossover series, an interesting comic, a poem, or some other form of writing literature, send it in to us. We'll see if we can fit it in. If you've got the fan art that goes with it, send that in too. If you're not sure what you want to write or you haven't written anything yet, we've been putting a few prompts into the Knights into Zines Discord server. And the next issue of Knights into Zines itself is going to feature some of those prompts. So keep your eye open and take a look. See if any of them can inspire you to write a poem, a short story, a chapter, maybe even your own alternate universe. That could be fun, right? So give it a shot. And we hope you enjoyed this issue of Knights into Dreams Taste Test audio format. Sweet dreams, everybody.